Nothing. just come to be.
Gunop still waiting, Pak Budiman. Pak Ahmad, bisa yes. Saya lagi? Apa-apa. Yang masker aja, Pak.
Done, I make you to be that again. They say, dance for me.
Mulai aja, Bu Nok. Pak Budiman sudah ada. Pak Yus. Halo, Pak Yus.
Coba share screen.
Ya, siap. Benar-benar siap.
Oke.
Oke, Kang Dika.
Yes. Bu Nop.
Siap. Mulai aja, Bu.
Ya, silakan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Attention please, the webinar will be starting shortly. All of the participants are invited to on the video and mute the speaker. Thank you. I am Novi Malisa, will be the host in this webinar. I would like to inform that all participants are expected to fill in the attendance link, which we will share via chat Zoom. We will give certificates for the webinar to all participants who fill in attendance link. Thank you. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. His Excellency, the Chairman of Indonesian National Nurses Association, West Java Province, Dr. Budiman. The Honorable Chairman of Aipviki in Region 4, West Java Banten, Mrs. Nenden Lesmanawati, MSE. The Honorable All Speakers, Mr. Ius Yosep, PhD from Pajajaran University Indonesia, Professor Datuk Dr. Hajah Bibi Florina from Lincoln University College, Malaysia, Mrs. Hartia Harun, PhD from Pajajaran University Indonesia, Dr. Jericho Pardosi from Queensland University of Technology, Australia. All the co-hosts that support this webinar include Akbar RS Dustira, Universitas Jenderal Ahmad Yani, Akbar Dharma Husada Cirebon, Akbar YPIB Majalengka, Akbar Al Ikhlas, Universitas Bakti Kencana, Poltekkes Yapkesbi, Universitas Aisyah Bandung, Stikes Raflesia, Stikes Ahmad Dahlan, Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya, Poltekkes TNI AU Ciumbuluit, Akper Kesdam Iskandar Muda Loksemawe, Perhimpunan Mahasiswa Indonesia, Lincoln University College Malaysia, Riva Corporation, and my beloved all participants in this webinar. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good morning and may the peace of Allah be upon you. First of all, let us pray and praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has been giving us blessings and mercies, so we can attend in this webinar in the good condition. Salawat and salam are always given to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had brought us to the path of light and left the darkness in this life. Ladies and gentlemen, before we come to the main session, let us start this by praying first, so the event that we will hold this day will run well without any obstacle at all. Let us begin this webinar by saying basmalah together. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Ladies and gentlemen, to initiate the webinar, we shall hear the National Anthem of Republic Indonesia and Inna March. Thank you.
Sejawat nasional Indonesia, wujud ikatan profesi perawatan. Tempat membina dan mengembangkan kemampuan diri dalam membuktikan keberadaannya. Menapaklah dengan keyakinan lebih pasti, sejajar dalam hatikan diri. Bangkit berdiri dan lengkapkan kakimu itu, menatap hari esok penuh asa. Wahai perawat Indonesia, bangkitlah dan majulah untuk menolong sekalian yang menderita. Kuatkanlah pribadimu, tingkatkan pengetahuan untuk memberikan asuhan keperawatan. Kita melangkah untuk mengisi pembangunan bangsa negara Indonesia, untuk mengantarkan bangsa menuju sehat semua dengan semangat jiwa Pancasila. Maju perawat, majulah dalam kancah pembangunan, tunjukkanlah pada sekalian orang. Jadilah perawat model kesehatan bangsa kita, jadilah teladan dalam hidup sehat. Bangkitlah perawat seluruh Indonesia dalam mengemban citra profesi, menjunjung tinggi kode etik keperawatan, laksanakan panggilan tugas mulia. Tercapai derajat kesehatan seoptimal mungkin bagi warga negara Indonesia. Sebagai bukti kiprahnya mahkota putih suci dalam mendukung pembangunan kesehatan. Dengan organisasi PPNI yang kokoh, padu bersatu, serta selaras, perawat Indonesia akan mampu angkat citranya di mata insan dunia.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to listen to the welcoming speech delivered by Mrs. Nenden Lesmanawati as the chairman of Aipviki in Region 4, West Java, Banten. To Mrs. Nenden Lesmanawati, time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Novi. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah, all praises are to Allah, the most beneficent and the most merciful, by whose grace and blessing have enabled us to gather here for the conference. Salawat and salam may always be delivered to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who has guided us from the darkness to the lightness. Good morning, distinguished guest speakers and participants. I am Nenden Lesmanawati. On behalf of the Aipviki West Java and Banten, I would like to welcome all of you to our conference. Thank you for being here with us today. Before we proceed the conference, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to Dr. Budiman as the chief of PPNI West Java Province. Thank you for your coming. To Professor Dr. Hajah Datuk Bibi Florina, thank you always inspire me to be a great woman. Dr. Yus Yosef, thank you because you and Rifa Corporation always support me. You are my mentor for my life and my career. To Dr. Hartia Harun, thank you for your coaching in my English and happy to learn with you. And of course, Dr. Jericho Pardosi, thank you for your kindness. Thank you for our collaboration. I hope our collaboration is not only now, but can continue in the future. In addition, my special thanks to all partners, all co-hosts, sponsors, and the conference organizer who generously helped us to make this conference come true. Special thanks to Mrs. Novi Malisa, Mrs. Dewi Hastuti, Mr. Dika Darmansah, Mrs. Dina Apriani, Mr. Dede Ajis Muslim, Mr. Ahmad Ramdhani, and all of the committee for the important collaboration and support to this conference. Ladies and gentlemen, in this conference, we will discuss about building the resilience of lecturers and students and increasing international cooperation in the era of COVID-19 pandemic. As we know, our students are Generation Z, which is internet generation. They can find out almost everything from the internet. For some extent, they are more familiar with the virtual environment than the actual environment around them. The internet offers a lot of positive impact on our lives, but many negative impacts also threatening. Negative internet content may cause the Z generation more vulnerable to become apathetic, individualistic, egocentric, and lazy persons. In the other hand, the situation of COVID-19 pandemic has been causing the increased student dependency to internet. Many times, students spend a lot of time surfing in cyberspace, even during study hours. Many students become easily anxious, frustrated, and even depressed. It is quite frequently reported that teenagers being victims of crime, fraud, cyberbullying, pornography, and discrimination, and the most terrible thing is the increasing number of suicide committed by teenagers because they are not strong enough to cope with the negative effects of the internet. Therefore, coping and resiliency skills are important for students. This should be integrated into the education curricula and it should be implemented as early as possible to save the younger generation. One of the key is resiliency. Lecturer must have resiliency and be able to be a role model for their student to improve the resiliency skill. For this reason, this international conference is conducted with the aim that lecturers and students can have strong resilience in facing this COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. Last but not least, allow me to convey some encouragement to my students who are here in the conference. Be brave to speak up. Be confident to create something different and change your mindset from negative to positive. Be a technology developer or inventor instead of only users. And for all lecturers, let's be creative in teaching. Let's create essential transformationing teaching which make our students healthy and happy. Ladies and gentlemen, and all the distinguished conference participants. To sum up my speech, let me once again, on behalf of the organizer of this conference, deliver a deep appreciation and thank you to all for your willingness to attend and share in this conference. Finally, may all of you have a great and fruitful conference. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Mrs. Nandan Lesmanawati, for that wonderful speech. Ladies and gentlemen, the welcoming speech and the opening of the webinar by the Chairman of Indonesian National Nurses Association, West Java Province, the Honorable Dr. Budiman, you are pleased to deliver the speech and open the webinar.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Orang Indonesia. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Budiman. I am a chairman of Indonesia National Nurse Association, PPNI, West Java Province. It is a wonderful thing for me to give speech in this big event international webinar with the theme building the resilience of lecturer and student and increasing international cooperation in the era of COVID-19 pandemic. I see, tadi saya lihat Bu Nenden luar biasa tuh pidatonya. Ketua Aipviki Jabar Banten.
Thank you. Terima kasih.
The Honorable Mrs. Nenden Lesnawati, Chairman of APG in Region 4, West Java Province. The Honorable Associate Professor Yusuf Sepisdi, beliau teman saya, my friend is the best. From Pajajaran University and Prof. Datuk. Dr. Hajah Bibi Foren from Lincoln University College, Malaysia. Welcome to Indonesia, Prof. Datuk. Dr. Hartia Harun from Pajajaran University Indonesia. Ini beliau senior saya nih, Dr. Hartia Harun. Thank you telah hadir dalam kegiatan seminar internasional. I think kegiatan internasional the best. And Dr. Jericho Fardosi from Queensland, University of Technology, Australia. And the honorable all participants who attended this big event. I see pesertanya luar biasa ya. 470. I am proud and happy now that Aipviki West Java Banten can organizing in international scala event in the future after the seminar. Aipviki is expected to be able to increase international cooperation, especially in the field of education and health. FNE is effectively involved in full support various scientific activity held the content of professional and academic development. The professional organization PPNI always aspire to be at the forefront of the nursing innovation process in Indonesia and continue to strive for the nursing field to become more advanced and higher quality. Saya lihat IPK Jawa Barat, Banten, luar biasa kegiatannya ya, dalam rangka mengkoordinir kegiatan-kegiatan institusi pendidikan di diploma ketiga keperawatan. PPNI West Java currently has a motto, "Lead closer and useful." This motto is our determination to be friendly with nature and people, and that we want to be some who not only exist and is present in the world, but also become a person who is meaningful and beneficial to all mankind. It is undeniable that our current challenges are getting bigger, especially with the pandemic and the era of society 5.0. Saya kira teknologi 5.05 ini memang perlu kita hadapi ya, baik tantangan di saat ini. FNI also support the development of women research and the education system in Indonesia for the reason FNI is ready to actively contribute and collaborate with the government, institutional association, university stakeholder, and the community to create a smart, young generation with good character. To quote, of behalf of the chairman of the PPNI West Java by saying, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, I officially open the international seminar with okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Budiman. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, then we will watch the sponsor videos from Riva Corporation and Permai Lincoln University College.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat datang di Riva Corporation. Saya Aymar Dias sebagai Direktur Riva Corporation.
Saya Yusyosef General Manager Riva Corporation.
Perusahaan kami berdiri sejak tahun 2002 dan terus berkembang mulai sekarang kurang lebih ada 16 tahun. Dari mulai melayani hanya 40 mahasiswa dan sekarang sudah sekitar 500 mahasiswa yang kami layani. Dari mulai dulu hanya 2 asrama, sekarang sudah kurang lebih mencapai 10 asrama.
Fokus pelayanan kami adalah memberikan servis, memfasilitasi student di seluruh Indonesia dalam bidang dormitoris atau asrama. Pelayan-pelayan kami terdiri dari tenaga-tenaga muda yang energik dan profesional yang sudah dilatih service excellence. Sebagian lagi adalah tenaga-tenaga senior yang akan memberikan pelayanan secara penuh empati.
Dalam pembelajaran ini. Yang pertama adalah rumah sakit, yang kedua adalah mahasiswa dari suatu institusi, dan yang ketiga adalah akomodasi. Tiga hal ini penting dalam pembelajaran.
Just
Alright. Ladies and gentlemen, here come the main agenda of the webinar with theme building the resilience of lecturers and students and increasing international corporations in COVID-19 pandemic era. That will be moderated by Mrs. Dina Apriani, MCOP. Ms. Dina, are you ready? All right. Now, I would like to inform you the curriculum vitae of our moderator. Yeah. Her name is Mrs. Dina Apriani, SKPMKEP. Her educational background is Master of Nursing at Nursing Faculty, Indonesia University, graduated in 2010, and currently she is taking her doctoral program at Medicine Faculty, Pajajaran University. Now she works as lecturer at the Faculty of Health Science and Technology, Jenderal Ahmad Yani University. She has a lot of experience in research, publication, and organization. And I'm so sorry I couldn't read them all because it will take thousands of full moons. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mrs. Dina Apriani.
Thank you, Mrs. Novi, for the time. Now it's my turn to lead the main session. Good morning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Welcome to the international webinar, which is held by Aipviki Region 4. First, let me introduce myself. My name is Dina Apriani. I am as your moderator for this session. Before we begin, I have a few information for all of the audience. The first is each speaker in this session will have a total of 3 minutes for their presentation. And the second is after two speakers present their topics, there will be time a discussion. So the third is if you have any question for the speaker, please raise your virtual hand or turn on your microphone. When I call you, you ask to ask a question or you can also the chat feature in this session. And to ask your question, then I will read your question out of loud. And the last one is the webinar will be divided into two sessions. Each session consists of two speakers. That's so I can tell you about the information. First of all, I would like to welcome all of these speakers. In this webinar, we would like to have a speaker from Pajajaran University, from Lincoln University College Malaysia, and the Queensland University Technology Australia. Before the presentation, let me introduce the first speaker. He is Mr. Ius Yosef, PhD, from Pajajaran University. Let me read a brief of his CV. Mr. Ius, how are you, Mr. Ius? Nice to meet you.
Alhamdulillah, sehat.
Okay, Mr. Ius Yosef, his full name and title is Haji Ius Yosef, SKP, Master of Science, MSE, Master of Science, PhD. He's completed doctor in mental health nursing University Malaysia Sarawak in 2020. And also right now, he is a lecturer in mental health nursing, faculty nursing, Pajajaran University, and become a general manager, Rifa Corporation Nursing Learning Center. And now let me please welcome our first speaker, Mr. Ius Yosef. To deliver your topic is about effective tips for strengthening resilience toward the post-pandemic next normal. All right, Mr. Ius Yosef, the time is yours and no more than 30 minutes to present your topic. Thank you, Mr. Ius, please.
Thank you, Mrs. Dina. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Wilujeng enjing ka sadayana.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning, wilujeng enjing Pak Ius.
First of all, I would like to say my thankfulness and the chance you have was given to me. I would like to say congratulations for all that you have joined with the international webinar in which hosted by Aipviki West Java Banten. And special thanks to the Honorable Chairperson of Aipviki West Java Banten, Mrs. Nenden Smanawati, as Kepnes MSE, the Honorable of Chairperson of Indonesian Nurse Association, West Java, Dr. Budiman, and to all my best teacher, Professor Datuk Bibi Florina, Dr. Harti Harun, and Dr. Zeriko. The title of my presentation is Effective Tip for Strengthening the Self-Resilience Toward the Post-Pandemic Snack Normal. And besides that, I would like to say selamat berbuka untuk semua. Maksudnya selamat berpuasa, bukan berbuka. Baik. There are six sub-topic that we will discuss in this presentation. The first is the meaning of resilience. The second is a bonding as a part of resilience. And the third, the importance of positive perception in resilience. And next, we will discuss about tip application and coping how to strengthening the resilience. Okay. The simplest definition of resilience has been explained by Cooper. The ability of person or object to spring back into self or the capacity to recover quickly from difficulties. Or in Indonesian terminology, it is called as kelenturan seseorang dalam menghadapi masalah. It means that the keyword of this definition are flexibility, elasticity, and ability to return to the original self. To understand more about resilience, I would like to give you an illustration. This can be compared to a Balinese dancer who is a flexibility and elastic. Balinese dancer can perform a various movement with very good coordination. For example, the head look to the right, the eyes glance to the left, and hand to forward, buttock to the back, and legs to the side. In everyday life, a person can face to the various problems, such as a financial partner officer. For example, the demand of Scopus publication for lecture, someone has a high resilience will be able to deal with it in the relaxed manner. But on the other hand, there are a people who are rigid or kaku, yeah, and perfectionist until they finally break, or in Indonesian terminology, it is known as broken heart or frustration. Jadi orang yang memiliki resilience yang tinggi memiliki sifat lentur, mudah beradaptasi, dan menghadapi berbagai masalah. Financial partner, office, focus, and others bisa beradaptasi secepat mungkin. I would like to continue to the bouncing. As a part of resilience, bouncing back is the ability to cope what other life throw at you. Some people are knocked down by challenge, but they return a stronger person more steadily than before. Jadi orang yang memiliki resilience yang tinggi akan kembali bangkit dari keterpurukan secara cepat. Fall, but bouncing. Rise again for adversity. Sad, but just for a moment. Stronger than ever and move dynamically. Cepat kembali untuk beraktivitas. Sedihnya sebentar. Here is an example how resilience applied in the pandemic. Jadi beberapa contoh bagaimana seseorang yang resilient di era pandemic ini. After the pandemic, learn Zoom and information technology immediately. Oh, ini saatnya kita belajar teknologi. Cope to the campus demand, lecture to continue online PhD for efficiency. Oh, ini anugerah dari Allah bahwa kita bisa melakukan PhD secara online. After business disrupted by pandemic, struggle and learn more about online marketing. Dua tahun dihantam pandemik, bangkrut, maka inilah saatnya belajar online marketing. When someone got jobless, it mean have enough time to focus on parenting for children. Ketika di PHK, dia berpikir bahwa inilah saatnya saya memfokuskan diri untuk membangun kembali keluarga yang saat ini sering ditinggalkan. If you would like to discussion about resilience, it related with the equilibrium state in our body. If the perception of COVID is excessive, the source for support is small, and the coping mechanism is maladaptive, then a person will experience mental illness. I think the perception is very important in the case of how to adapt with COVID-19 pandemic. Mental disorder can occur when someone have a negative perception about stressor. For example, COVID is useless at all. Swab positive means the end of the world. Jadi kalau di swab positif ini apa tuh sama dengan dunia ini hancur itu ya, dunia berakhir. COVID, there are no religious activity. Ya, tidak perlu lagi ibadah. Online learning is very bad. Online learning itu sangat buruk, sangat menjemukan. COVID economy collapse, no opportunity. Ekonomi akan jatuh, tidak ada kesempatan lagi. It is the example that the perception is negative. If someone have a negative perception, it can cause disequilibrium, and it should be balancing with coping and resource for support, enough resource for support. The people who have high resilience, wherever they are, always become a winner. For example, someone in the cancer ward, in the Olympic, in the boardroom, because if the environment cannot be changed, then they will do adaptation. Dimanapun dia berada, orang resilient ini selalu menjadi pemenang. Apakah di ruangan kanker, apakah dalam pertandingan olimpiade, atau di tempat yang luas. Kenapa? Dia selalu mencari hikmah, dia selalu beradaptasi, dan akhirnya dia bisa menemukan solusi atau alternatif untuk pemecahan masalah. Okay, we would like to the next slide. There are four key point of resilience component. The first is change, growth mindset, and creative strong. Resilient people recognize that a crisis is time for change, from lesser to greater, from smaller to bigger. For example, in the pandemic situation, one university in Japan has changed the graduation ceremonial using robotics. Even though the coronavirus will disappear, the new innovation and change always come very quickly. Satu bentuk resiliensi sebuah university di Jepang. Globally, there are two categories of mindset. The first is a fixed mindset, and the second is growth mindset. Resilience can only be done in the growth mindset category with a special characteristic, in which such as confront uncertainties. Dia ikhlas menghadapi segala sesuatu. Embracing challenges. Siap bersedia menerima tantangan. And not afraid to fail. Dia tidak takut gagal. Berani gagal dan siap menerima kegagalan. I think it is the characteristic of growth mindset. I'd like to continue with the resilient can generate a creativity. For example, to help his mother, who is visually impaired, during the pandemic, a vocational high student create an omelette robot. Ini salah satu contoh di daerah Jawa ya. Karena ibunya harus berdagang telur, kemudian ibunya mengalami gangguan penglihatan, di masa pandemi itu tetap harus punya penghasilan, maka si anak ini menciptakan robot untuk memasak telur membantu ibunya.
Telur dadar mini menarik perhatian yang melihatnya.
Robotnya.
Robotnya kenapa?
Gerak sendiri.
Gerak sendiri.
Robot yang diberi nama Egg Filling Robot ini merupakan karya seorang pemuda lulusan sebuah SMK negeri di Purworejo, Jawa Tengah. Telur dadar mini.
Oke. Okay. I would like to propose the idea of a GitLab as a tip for strengthening the resilience. The first, God will not a given burden beyond our ability. As Islamic religion said that, la yukallifullahu nafsan illa wus'aha. Bahwa Tuhan tidak akan membebani seorang luar kemampuan, bahwa kita selalu akan lebih kuat dari masalah. Ini sebagai spirit untuk resilient. And the second, increase experience in different place and situation to multiple synapse branching. Otak kita, sinap kita perlu jalan-jalan. Ya. Perbanyak jalan-jalan ke gunung, ke pantai, tebing, laut, ke luar negeri, ke situs kaum Ad, kaum Samud, Fir'aun, ke benteng Muhammad Al-Fatih. It will give impact to multiple synapse branching. And if you have a multiple synapse branching, it means you have so many alternative to problem solving. Sometimes we had something, even though it is good for us. As Quranic said, wasa antakluhu saya wahuwa harulakum, wasa antuhibu saya wahuwa sarulakum. Walahu yalamun wa antum latalamun. Ada kalanya kamu membenci sesuatu, padahal itu baik bagi kamu. Ada kalanya kamu menyukai sesuatu, padahal itu buruk bagi kamu. Sesungguhnya Allah Maha tahu, kamu tidak tahu. Resilient mean ikhlas and ridho to what everything Allah decree. And then learn from people who have physically limitation. As we know, like Nick Pugicic, Sam Burn, and Velasquez, sebagai motivator kelas dunia yang memiliki kecatatan, ya. And all important thing have a handle. Life has a guide. Untuk resiliensis, semua benda penting itu ada pegangannya, ya. Kehidupan ada panduannya. Demikian juga resiliensis itu ada aturannya. Sebagai contoh, ya. Setrika, pintu, pisau, motor, tas ada pegangannya. Similar with this, that our life has a guide and manner. And then, or the last, build hope. Hopeless people can live much longer. Jadi orang mampu bertahan hidup beberapa hari tanpa makan, tapi orang putus asa, satu menit pun dia bisa bunuh diri. Build hope is very essential to building a resilience. It is the analogy of planting debt in the sand with burden and obstacle to grow. Debt has strong root, resilience has borne by the obstacle. Jadi tantangan dan halangan itu sebenarnya menyebabkan kita tumbuh. Resilience membutuhkan masalah. There is no resilience without the problem. Kita lihat ilustrasinya. Analogy of planting debt in the sand with burden and obstacle to grow, debt has a strong root. Oleh karena itu, di Timur Tengah kalau menanam kurma itu selalu ditindih dengan batu supaya akarnya lebih kuat. Resilient is the strength to keep growing. And in the last of my presentation, I would like to inform you the phenomena of there are 8 tips how to apply resilient. The first, reframing. Menurut kita harus mencari apa hikmahnya. And the practice of expressive writing. Saat masalah semua ada di kepala, kita harus mencoba menuliskannya, mengurutannya, ada masalah A, masalah B, masalah C. Sehingga menjadi lebih mudah diatasi. Itu riset para psikolog ya. Face your fear, coba hadapi. Biasanya masalah menjadi rumit karena dramatisasi diri kita sendiri, sedangkan Allah menjamin kita lebih kuat dari masalah. Remember that you are not alone. Ujian itu berlaku bagi semua orang. Anda atau kita bukan orang yang paling susah di muka bumi ini. Ya. Mediate or pray. Hanya kepada engkau lah aku minta pertolongan di Nasrul Mustaqim. And cultivate forgiveness. I think it is most important that melenyapkan dendam and memaafkan adalah sebagai penyembuh jiwa. And bring who are very meaningful. Kita harus menghadirkan significant person di dekat kita and hearing religious support atau mendengar ceramah agama. In the last of my presentation, I would like to inform you the phenomena of modern corporate such Apple, Google, Netflix phenomena in which you don't need a diploma or academic certificate to apply for job. It means who are the competent and resilient, they will be a winner. Jadi sekarang perusahaan modern seperti Apple, Google, Netflix itu sudah untuk melamar pekerjaan sudah tidak membutuhkan lagi ijazah. Kalau Anda mampu dan Anda resilient, Anda kuat, Anda akan diterima bekerja. It is how to cope and create in the future beside that sustainability environmentally friend, ramah lingkungan dan keberlanjutan menggunakan energi yang terbarukan, kemudian apprenticeship and internship, kita harus punya mentor, kita harus magang di tempat asli, and be owner of teaching hospitals, semua pendidikan punya rumah sakit sendiri, and modular education, modul pembelajaran mandiri secara online, kemudian non-linear, ini saatnya non-linear, nursing plus IT, transportasi plus IT, health plus robotik, bidan plus public speaking, dan seterusnya, and massive open online course. Cara terbaik untuk memprediksi masa depan adalah dengan menciptakannya bersama-sama. Okay, it is the last of my presentation. As a conclusion is, bila kita tidak bisa mengendalikan badai, kita masih bisa mengatur layar kita. Ada hal-hal yang tidak bisa kita kendalikan dalam hidup ini. Ada hujan, ada matahari, ada angin, ada cibiran perkataan orang lain. But we have to manage ourselves. Sometimes you need a little crisis to get your adrenaline flowing and help you realize your potential. Resilience is the flexibility, elasticity, and capability to back again to the first step. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Masya Allah. Luar biasa, Pak Yud. Thank you for the awesome presentation.
Thank you, Ibu Dina, Pak Yud, top share ya. Terima kasih.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Yud, for the awesome presentation. So, Pak Yud, the resilient people will become the winner, right? And so that's why the audience, let's become the resilience and the strength people from right now. Because as the Pak Yu said, that if we become the resilient people, we will become the winner. The audience, if you have any question for Mr. Yu, you can use the chat feature and raise your hand, but not now. Still patient and keep it on the discussion session. Pak Yus, please, you can stay and wait in room Zoom ya, Pak ya.
I am standby.
Okay, thank you, Pak Yus. Ladies and gentlemen, now we move to the next speaker from Linton College University Malaysia, which will be delivered by Prof. Datuk Dr. Hajah Bibi Florina, with the topic is about building resilience amidst the pandemic turmoil by expanding international cooperation network. Let me read her CV. Professor Datuk Dr. Hajah Bibi Florina Abdullah, her full name, the Pro-Chancellor of Lincoln University College, is the first Director of Nursing Ministry of Health Malaysia. She has also served as the Register of the Nursing Board Malaysia and has the greatest passion in the changing the full face of the nursing profession. She is instrumental in the professionalizing nursing, bringing in the to the next level from the diploma to a degree status. Undoubtedly, her passion in nursing and dynamism of change has transformed to the Lincoln University College. Prof. Datuk, nice to meet you. And how are you, Prof?
Yeah, okay, hello, yeah.
Okay, Prof. Time is your, and then Prof, as I tell you that I was meet you 2 years ago when I visited the Lincoln with Mr. Nenden. Nice to meet you again, Prof. And today is your time to deliver your presentation. No more than 30 minutes.
Thank you very much. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to all of you. Syukur Alhamdulillah, we are able to be here among friends. And thank you for inviting me this morning. And I must congratulate, Mrs. Menden and her team for this wonderful webinar or seminar, bringing us all together. And I'm very, very proud, of course, with all our PhD candidates, the Lincoln University College students. I have changed this topic yesterday. I told Mrs. Nenden because I was thinking that, you know, it's like almost the same topic, but I tried to make it that, you know, the contents of resilience is there. I must say that, you know, Pak Yus has presented a very, very wonderful, excellent and interactive presentation, which actually I'm very proud to listen in fact just now. And I'm quite fortunate because I'll summarize my presentation because I'm sure, you know, you have actually touched almost everything to be resilient in this challenging situation. When you talk about, look at the topic, one silver lining. Actually, I'm just trying to be positive here, looking at pandemic as a positive accelerator change, because it has been a very challenging time, and you know, a set environment, everybody has been affected with all this, the pandemic. So we are trying to look at it in a, you know, in a positive way, how it can be an accelerant for change, you know, in this era.
Michael.
So actually, as human beings, we all share the same sorrows, yeah, the same hopes, the same potential, and the COVID-19 pandemic actually has reminded us how interdependent we are. We actually need each other. And what happens to one person can soon affect many others, even on the far side of our planet, you know, basically the whole world. So actually we are currently going through one of the most significant historical changes ever experienced in the last 100 years. All businesses, even educational businesses, yeah, will change, and new businesses will actually emerge. So you're already seeing a shift in teaching methodologies, yeah, in our campuses, and adopting as a response to this pandemic. So basically, the problem is there. And, you know, this is now reminding to us how we respond to these challenges. So essential services in relation to healthcare, energy and natural resources, water emergency services, actually will continue to be in demand. So these are all the basic needs, and order the business models for these industries may change actually. So now we have to be ready, and as Pak Yu said, we need to be resilient. Actually, how do we act in an abnormal situation? So we need to be vigilant, basically cautious about the further impact of the spread of the virus, because it comes in many forms. Yeah, now we have the Omicron. Yeah, and of course we have to be resilient to create new ways of living and working. It is with us. How do we act on this? How do we run on run away from this? Basically, we need to be creating new ideas how to work together. Actually, so new ways of living and working will emerge as soon as fears subsides. Yeah, so let's start now by discussing ways to reimagine and reinvent our lives, our organization, and our society. Basically, our fear has subsided, because actually I just came back from Nigeria about 4 weeks ago. So in fact, we were so frightened to go there, but then, because of the we need to continue our businesses, so we need to find ways and means how we have to face a challenge. So from Nigeria, I was actually in Sri Lanka and I was in Nepal. So in these three countries, I tell you, the cautions that they have taken, and we have to go through all the processes, all the processes of of avoiding these diseases and of protecting us, not only to protect us, but also to protect other people from the virus. So basically, new ways of living and working will emerge as soon as the fear subsided. That is what I said. So acceleration of digital transformation actually is the notion now. So the notion of digital transformation is now fairly advanced with many organizations, also in LinkedIn. In fact, we are now starting with this digitalization on the online teaching, and of course on transforming businesses over the last 2 years. In fact, during the last 2 years, during the pandemic, even though we are not supposed to be working, but we are working at home, so we try our best to find ways, because we know that it's going to be here and it's going to last. So somehow or other, if we have to continue living, we have to find ways and means how to react to the situation. So COVID-19 will force companies to take radical steps to adopt technology advancement and modernize culture, basically, and organizational structure, measurement system, and operating architecture. So basically, the whole system has to change, not only the infrastructure, but also the pedagogies, right? So actually, there's a common agreement among top businesses leaders, that even if the organization is ahead today, they have to be continually prepared to change, take calculated risks, and be prepared to fail fast, or their businesses is likely to get disrupted. So basically, we have to find ways as mean, and therefore accelerating digital transformation journeys would become a top priority for many companies, especially in the education, to ensure businesses continuity, improve productivity, and launch new business model to remain competitive. So even in this challenging world, we have to be competitive. That is why when we go around the world, especially LinkedIn, we have a lot of collaborations, and then we have to ensure that our businesses continue, especially with this education. How do we ensure that online teaching, or digitalization is effective? It's just as good as the physical face to face, and we have to think ways and means, how to go about doing it. So COVID-19 is currently very much a part of our normal life, and will likely to continue to be significant shaper and influencer of the immediate future. So people have an amazing capacity to adapt and thrive, actually. So we are now, the fear is subsiding. We are now trying to adapt and adopt the situation. And we try to, to respond in a very, very positive way. So we know the future looks very uncertain. We do not know. But we don't know when or if our societies might return to normal, Yeah, perhaps it is something beyond what you and I can control. But the good news is our mindset and attitude towards what is happening out there is something we can control. Yeah, so basically we are changing our mindset, as what you said just now. Yeah, so it is an inner game, actually. So today, I would like to share with you on ways to master our inner game so that we can continue to excel in our future, in especially in our studies and also profession in the face of hardship. So look at this. Huh? What the caterpillar calls the end of the world, the master calls a butterfly. Right. So as I start, I like to share a story with you. So what you see is an imaginary of life being transformed into something magical. That is why I said, let's look at pandemic as an accelerant of, you know, a positive change. So I'm pretty sure that you have seen this metaphor of caterpillar and butterfly, which is a biological process of nature, actually. So, but what this story describes is a felt sense of how our psyche changes and how our consciousness grow in the face of challenges. Basically, it's a felt sense, yeah? So people often withdrawn at this time and feel like they are distancing, yeah? Distancing themselves from their dreams, ambitions, and ideas during this transformational process. So they thought it's the end of the world, huh? There's no, you know, other ways. But we cannot return to the world as it was before, you know? For example, the pandemic has gone through our life. We want to go as before, maybe, but with a different kind of situation. So with self-determination, backed by the right attitude, we're all talking about the right attitude, the right mindset, yeah? You will not stay stagnant, but instead, this is the time when you acquire a new set of skill, yeah? To learn how to master the skill of flying, for example. The same applies to you when you equip yourself with a new skill set, yeah? So increase your abilities to open up new and better opportunities on the international platform. So we are talking about, you know, how do you prepare yourself to collaborate internationally, yeah? To network internationally. So the current global health crisis also reminds us that what affects the human family has to be addressed by all of us. Yeah. So parents everywhere have realized the value of universities and appreciated the hard work of lecturers. The government have understood that economy and society depends on the education in the here and now as well as the long term. So this is a very important area, you know, education. So how do we ensure that it is relevant, you know? Teaching methodologies, you know, how do we ensure that it's relevant, the infrastructure that we have in the university before, how do you make it relevant, yeah? But I can't say I'm optimistic, yeah, exactly, but I look to the future with determination to turn crisis into opportunities, yeah? If you handle the crisis well, it can be your opportunity. Actually, that is a saying by one great Chinese philosopher called Confucius, yeah? When you are faced with a problem or face a crisis, if you handle it properly, it will become your opportunity. So what we need is for those in power to do the same thing. Yeah, those in control of our infrastructure, of our university, and the government, how to make it, you know, possible for everyone to achieve their goal, to keep their dream in this situation. So history suggests that predicting economic downturns, yeah, global conflicts and viral pandemic can often be impossible. It is impossible, yeah. The same can be said for unforeseen challenges in our personal life. How we handle this hardship and challenges will allow us to bounce back and overcome the setback in the most effective way possible. That is why I said, whatever challenges you are facing, you know, it doesn't really matter. What matters is how do you respond to the challenges? How do you respond, yeah? So resilience and possessing a resilient mindset. I don't have to explain to you about resilience anymore, but you said I explained very beautifully just now. Now I would like to say that resilience and possessing a resilient mindset is not a trait that people are born with. It can be acquired, yeah? Cambridge Dictionary describes as a set of behaviors, thoughts and action that can be learned and developed in any individual or organization, right? So basically, you know, the situation can make you resilient. Yeah, the pandemic make you resilient. Any hardship, you know, the many times that you have fallen, you have failed, for example, can make you resilient. So there are 5 methods and a combination to develop your resilience and to strengthen your resilient mindset. I thought I'd just share with you. I just read some literature review on this. So the first one is stay strong. Okay, resilient people and organizations are able to accept the reality of the situation, no matter how hard they may be. Okay, they are then able to overcome the challenge through an adaptive and positive mindset. The more difficult the scenario, the stronger they will become. So the key words here actually to remember is how do you adapt and be flexible. Now let me tell you, you know, for the last 2 years, almost 3 years now, we in Lincoln University College, we did not sit on our roller. We didn't just stay like that. So we managed to strengthen our position locally. For example, now Lincoln actually, for the second time running, we have the Setara 5, 5-star ranking from the Ministry of Education. And we are also, you know, in the world map, in terms of our education delivery. And this impact, actually this is an impact ranking by the UK. Actually, we are in 301, I think so. Oh, number 35, sorry. 301 actually was the QS Asia. And recently, we just developed into 251. So you see, how do we adapt to the situation? How do we make yourself better? You see, basically, you don't say, oh my God, this is a pandemic, what am I supposed to do? But not in in a competitive business like education. There's so many, you know, there's so many institutions. How do we make ourselves, you know, like relevant, the best in terms of, the curriculum, in terms of the new trends, the new updates and things like that. So basically, you know, you've got to adapt and be flexible to the situation. As I said, the response is more important. Yeah, how do you respond to the situation? And the second one is a continuous growth, actually is the key. So life does not get easier or more forgiving. It is not, all right? With every negative event encountered, we grow stronger and become more resilient. Yeah, it was also, said by you just now. So resilient people and organizations know that facing difficulty is inevitable, but choosing to learn from them is optional, all right? So resilient individuals know that without hardship, resilience can be built, and without practicing resilience, we can't grow. So basically, we need an issue. We need a challenge. Yeah? You need to fall many times. So because that is not the end, right? It is not fatal. Yeah, it is not fatal. Falling is not fatal, right? So basically, a downturn is also the perfect opportunity for your company or your institution to refine your product offering. Product here is basically the curriculum, right? Exposing your messaging or to strengthen your brand, and you will dipping your competition when the classes is over. So here the keywords is learning and evolving. You know, how do you learn after a fall? How do you evolve after that? You know, from a caterpillar to a butterfly. How do you evolve with all the changes? Yeah, because especially as I said, in a competitive business like education, we really need to be very, very relevant, yeah? Because, you know, everybody is growing, yeah? Everybody will say that they are the best, but we want to be different, okay? How do we make a difference from everybody? Next. So we need to plan for the future. Resilient people and organizations seek solution to problem rather than becoming paralyzed by the pessimism. As I said, you don't have to be worried. You don't have to, so worried that, what happened to me. You don't become paralyzed with that pessimism. Instead, you need to seek solution to that problem, all right? And then in the face of temporary setback, they do not lose sight of their long-term goals and they're able to adapt their plans accordingly to fit with the current situation. So I'll give an example again. There was a pandemic and our goal is to have a lot of collaboration. And at this point in time, we have about 400 collaboration, in fact, around the world. So we must not lose sight of the fact of that goal because of the temporary setback. So basically you need to be sensitive to the changes. Yeah, the changes here is the pandemic. So how do we respond to it? So the most important, you know, as I keep on repeating, how do you respond? You don't have to worry too much. You have to think how to solve the problem. So being prepared for all situation is vital for success. Basically, you know, there's a saying that, you know, life is not about going by the current. It is going against the current. Basically, we need to be alert all the time. Otherwise, you'll be swept away by the current. So basically, you need to be able to know what is the changes, what is, you know, the best for everybody. How do we ensure that we are also among those people who want to keep on, you know, not to say change for what, but change for the better. Yeah. So we must be prepared all the time. And the key words here is planning and preparation is very, very important. You know, whatever your goal is before, you have to ensure that, you know, even with temporary setback, even with temporary hardship, the goal has to be there. You must not lose sight of the goal. Okay. So the next one is, of course, the humility. Yeah, be kind to others. Even in the toughest of time, resilient people and organization show care for others, because kindness and compassion is the ultimate demonstration of our core values, especially in the health, you know, the health setup, you know, being nurses, you know, midwives and all those healthcare people, you know, our core value basically is the caring and to be selfless. Yeah, you must not only think of yourself, but for other people. That is the best method of discovering your own inner strength. Yeah, in spite of everything, all the challenges you're facing, all the hardship, but you'll be able to show that very important core value. So the key words here is you have to be supportive and empathetic in this situation, right? Next one. So remember, these two Sherpas, despite sometimes appearing like freak occurrences, these crises are often part of the business cycle. So it is crucial that you develop a resilient mindset in order to combat them whenever they may arise throughout your working career. So you need to control what you can. Control what you can, manage what you can, right? It's a mantra I like to live by, and it never has been more applicable than now. Okay, so basically you can control what you can, whatever is a problem, and you try to manage here is not by yourself, it's a teamwork, all right? A lot of teamwork, how you manage you know, an organization. So basically, if you can, then you need to manage by the help of people. Controlling is basically by yourself. Yeah. So the world in crisis needs international cooperation, basically, because we need to solve the problem together. Yeah, as we are now trying to discuss, how do we go about, you know, being resilient, facing all these things? How do we go about, you know, disseminating knowledge in a situation like this? Okay, so COVID-19 unprecedented global learning disruption has shown the weaknesses and gaps of education system around the world, basically. But it has also shown the strength and vital necessity of multilateralism, partnership, and cooperation at the global level to find sustainable solutions that can lift the education sector out of this challenging crisis. And for that to happen, yeah, the world must reinforce its global cooperation mechanism for education. So basically, we need to think of how do we deliver education in this, you know, in this situation. How do we share, you know, the ways and means, the mode, you know, of delivery and things like that. So, you know, to have webinar like this, you know, to come to together on how best we can disseminate information actually is the best way. So basically, you know, when there's a world crisis, the international cooperation is very much needed. So new mindset will drive future success, of course, with the, you know, paradigm shift from that day until now, yeah, anjakan paradigma. So the new mindset will drive future success. So with the rapidness of change we are undergoing as a society, if people and our companies or education institutions do not change with our new reality, they will be left behind, as I said. And it will be difficult to catch up with the number of iteration of change. So as technology enabled transformation is imperative, like the robot just now, as was seen, New mindset for humans will be the driver to see a successful implementation to propel businesses forward. And businesses here in our context is all about healthcare, is all about education. Yeah. And then cultural change will become one of the most important drivers of success for companies in post-COVID-19 era. So the ground rules here, you have to have the belief and the assumption that drive culture will require rethinking with a new set of mindset, driving employee with these successes. Basically, now you have a new mindset. Yeah, together with management and all employees, you have to think now with a new mindset, how do you drive forward? Yeah, everybody must work as a team, you know, in a very professional way, yeah, to ensure that, you know, you reach your goal, yeah, in a new norm. So they call it the new normal. How do you act in a new normal? So, you know, we cannot go back to the old ways. Now we have to continue. After the post-pandemic, we have to go on, continue our life and how to deliver our businesses. So no doubt, COVID-19 is challenging the status quo, yeah? Challenging. And conventional thinking across all industries. But recognizing some of the trends mentioned above and taking timely action, yeah? Will help individual and companies gain an advantage in this world of disruption. So basically what I was trying to tell you here is, how the pandemic has sort of changed our life and how do we look at it? How do we respond to this situation, yeah, in order to be relevant? So basically you must have a change mindset, yeah, to be, as a driver of success for future. So this concept can be applied to any situation. It can be any businesses with education, in the hospital, in any way. So the most important thing is, because we are now living actually with this phenomena, you know, and how do we, you know, live with it in a very safe way. So that is what I was trying to tell you. So thank you very much and stay safe always. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you for the wonderful and interesting topic, Prof. Bibi. Ladies and gentlemen, today, right now, we will go into the discussion time. So the audience can ask the question, asking the question to the speaker, 2 or 3 questions. You can raise your hand or turn on your microphone. If I see from the chat room, I see some question, yeah, some question from the audience. If you don't mind, could you asking the question directly, the audience, to the speaker? Wait.
There is Susti Julpa, Pak Dika.
Dr. Lina Tio.
And then, I got the question from Dr. Lina Tio.
Yes. Could you answer the question, Payus?
Okay, terima kasih Ibu Dr. Lina Tio. How are you? Are you with me today, Dr. Lina Tio?
Dr. Lina, are you ready?
Yes, selamat pagi. Good morning, Payus.
Good morning. Yes,
how are you?
Pagi. Ini mohon maaf, Payus tidak bisa on cam, ada masalah jaringan ini. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Pertanyaan dari Dr. Lina Tio, sahabat Payus ya. So you go through your resilient when study in Sarawak as experience and go through the all problem. Of course, banyak sekali problemnya ya. Di tahun 2000, in the year of 2015, I filed in the UTS University Technology Sydney, Australia. There are no enough scholarship and lack of English ability. In the second semester, I should drop out. And I tried to call my colleague in Sarawak, Professor Jabida Putih, to accept me to continue my study in the year of 2016. The learning issue is we should be ready and equal to pile after the best effort. It is the key of our resiliences. And the second, setelah saya kenal Prof. Jabidah, setelah saya kenal Dr. Lina Tio, setelah saya kenal Profesor Bibi, Bu Nenden, and other, it is become a grace and rezeki bagi saya. It mean that resilient need networking and support system. I know Prof. Bibi, I know Dr. Lina Tio, I know Bu Nenden, I know Bu Dina Unjani and Dr. Budiman. I think it is become anugerah for us. That according to the theory of social capital, I learned in UK from my lecturer, Dr. Professor Foucault. He is the schizophrenic patient, but struggled to become a professor in University of Sunderland. He stated that rezeki seseorang sangat tergantung dari siapa yang dia kenalnya. It mean the silaturahmi and networking is very important to building resiliency. I think you know Dan Mila about this one, yeah. And the last, as you know that we have so many tasks and responsible in our life, yeah, such as office, family, business, study, social, parenting, pray, and other. We should have a special time to give a special attention to finishing our study. Kalau bisa di rumah itu ada satu tempat. Tempat kita bersemedi dan bertapa yang tidak bisa diganggu oleh siapapun. Nobody can disturb us just for 1 hour in every day. Di sana ada wifi-nya, di sana ada mejanya, di sana ada musik, di sana ada buku, also computer. And according to the professor from Japan, if you like to finish our project, just talk to yourself. It is just 1 minute I sitting on the table, apa? On the chair. Jadi hanya membicarakan gini untuk menyelesaikan masalah ini. Saya hanya duduk 1 menit saja di meja ini. Ternyata banyak orang yang tidak hanya 1 menit, bisa sampai 1 jam. Tapi katakan dalam diri supaya tidak menjadi burden to become resilient. It is just 1 minute you sit down in your room. In special room in rumah. Jadi kesimpulannya adalah every task need a special attention. We should tolerant to the failed. Kegagalan itu adalah satu mata uang itu dari dua keberhasilan kegagalan. Kalau kita ingin uang berarti harus siap dua-duanya. Begitu. I think you have a lot of experience than me, Dr. Lina Tio, because you are as the consultant of so many students in Indonesia to continue their PhD program. Mohon maaf kalau ada kesalahan dan campur sari ya bahasa Inggrisnya. Begitu, Dr. Lina Tio, thank you for your attention and congratulations for your doctor ya. Oke, Bu Dina, karena waktu terima kita lanjut kasih. Ke Pak Yus.
Thank you yeah, yeah. Pak Yus for the explanation.
Okay, ada pertanyaan berikutnya ya, Bu Lina, dari Asep Batu Jaman. Dari Pak Asep Batu Jaman.
Pak Yus, keep patient, please. Okay. Bentar. Now, we are going to the Prof. Bibi first, right, Pak Yus? Ya. Okay.
Bangga.
Okay, this is an equation to Prof. Bibi from the Akimal, Weni Raini. Akimal have a question is about how the way to build the success mindset for being constantly because the result for everything we did and what we'll do that rely on the our mindset is it bad or good? Prof?
Yeah, let me read again. Let me read.
Understand the question.
I'm trying to read. Okay, what did she say here? How the way to build the success mindset of being constantly because the result for everything we did and what we do that rely on our mindset is bad or good. Okay, just now I was talking about, you know, how do you go about if I have to go back and see, mindset is like, for example, now we have the pandemic, okay? We are faced with so many challenges, with so many, you know, issues and things like that, all right? And then if at all, we are faced with so much of problem and things like that. So what we have to do now is how do we change this? How do we change our mind, you know, to become positive, for example? That is why, you know, I make this topic like, you know, I make this topic, for example, I said, you know, the pandemic as a positive accelerant for change. So how do you make it that way? So how do you look it that way? So basically, you must have a personality that is more flexible, all right? That is more adaptable, you know? So you which is easier to adapt to a situation. So if you're faced with things like this, you don't have to be so panic. I said, how do you respond to it? So the best thing is, you know, how you best, how best to respond to all these things. So to change your mindset from here to there, actually, is basically, you have to go through a crisis. You have to go through a crisis, and then how do you face with it? So it's all depend on, you know, on your inner self. For example, some people, they cannot stand, you know, they become panic, they cannot stand, that sort of thing. But some people, you know, they are very strong, so they can face the challenge, and then, you know, and start, they will respond very, very fast. But I tell you, all of us who are in the healthcare industry should be able to act very fast, isn't it? Because we are handling life. So we are already there, actually. We are already there. But because, like, for example, this pandemic is a different kind of thing. You know, it's like the whole world is, you know, affected. It was, like, dangerous. Everybody's dying and things like that. So we become very, you know, very frightened. And we have a problem of how to go on with it. But basically, you know, when you're very calm, very calm, and look at the situation, how do we go about doing this? How do we respond to this? And that is, you know, then you can find a good solution. So, you know, for example, I give this one. Let me see. Okay. Look at this before. If I just look into my slide. Say, for example, there are five ways and recommendation to develop and resilient to strengthen your mindset. So you basically have to be strong, but you're already there. You know, you're already there. Big healthcare people, you know, especially nurses, midwives, doctors, and things like that. You're already there. You are very strong enough. You're very resilient because through your training, you have gone through all those hurdles, the hurdles of studying, the hurdles of, you know, how to ensure that you can master the whole anatomy and physiology in order for you to go further, for example, yeah. So, you know, that is very important. So they are always strong there. And then, so no matter how hard it may be, you can face that situation. So, and then the next thing is, how do you respond to it? How do you respond to such a situation? And you try to adapt and be a bit flexible. So this is one of the things that you need to be strong. And second thing, so it has to be like, you know, you need to be like, for example, as you go through, everything is like it's a learning process, it's an educational exposure. So when you have gone through, you learn something, and you have to change, just like the caterpillar when it becomes a butterfly. You need to change. So how do you change it according to the process that you've gone through? You've gone through the process. Now, from that, for example, pandemic area, you cannot go back anymore, you know. The butterfly cannot go back to the caterpillar, but you need to fly. You need to grow into the future. So basically, the growth is a continuous, you know, the continuous growth is continuous. Yeah, so that's the key. You need to know that, you know, how do I say this? Learn to let go of whatever is not good, okay? After you let go of that one, then you learn, change your mindset into looking into the future. So you try to be positive and see how things are, you know, in order to be able to be successful, actually. So to me, like, for example, everything is educational. For example, as I was listening to you all, the questions and all those speakers, the speaker before, it's very educational to me. So those exposure, now will help you to change your mindset. So basically, you have to be very open mind. You don't close, yeah? Open mind, try to listen more. And after you listen more, then you can think how you go about, you know, evolving. How do you go about doing the, you know, to continue your life. So the next one is, so after you have all those things, then you plan for the future. how you go about, you know, planning, how to prepare, especially if you're a lecturer, okay, you're a lecturer now. Let me tell you what we are doing in Inter. We are going for digitalization. So everything will be online. But even if it is online, how you can make online teaching and learning to be effective? That is your goal. Because the outcome has to be that the student understand everything, all right? So you have to prepare and plan and prepare on this new mindset, on these new normals of, you know, delivering education, for example. So this is some of the things that, you know, and, you know, as I said here, be kind to others, because it helps. It's all like, you know, it's all like in a nutshell. Everything has to be in there, you know, change your mindset, what set of people, what set of character you have. As I said before, it is not like inborn, it can be acquired through the process of all the failures, all the success, all the exposure. And after you go through those processes, then you come out with a new mindset. Yeah, it's a paradigm shift to this one. So that's how about that is how you go about doing this thing. The most important thing is an open mindset. Yeah? And of course, the next one, of course, you have to remember that, you know, in spite of all those things, occurrences and all those things, sometimes, you know, it is not easy also to change. So as I said here in the word, control what you can. Yeah. And manage which you can. If you can, then you have to manage in a team. Because managing is all about using people, all right, to achieve it all. So I hope it helps you a little bit. Huh? All right.
Thank you, Prof, for your explanation. Yeah. So because I'm so sorry because the time is 10 minutes left. Yes, so yeah. I will give an opportunity to the participants who has raised their hands, yeah. I think the two questions is enough, yeah, because the first session will be ended. And the first question is Bu Julfa. Silakan Bu Julfa. Bu Julfa, yeah. And then the last one is Pak Fahru, yeah. Pak Fahru.
Yes.
Thank you, Miss Dina. I have one question which I want to give to Mr. Ius Yosef. Mr. Ius Yosef, nice to meet you, Mr. Ius.
Yeah, thank you, Bu Julfa. Nice to meet you too.
I would like ask about the difference between resilient person and principle. What is the difference between resilient and principle? Because in the post-pandemic, some person who has any principle sometimes hardly to resilient in any condition. That's all, Mr. Ius. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Bu Julfa. Ya, Pak Ius.
Okay. It means there are a different people, different ability, different background, education, different economical status, and different belief. It means give impact to different capability to resilient. It is okay that Allah menciptakan berbangsa-bangsa, bersuku-suku untuk saling mengenal, saling membantu, saling menciptakan peluang untuk berpahala. We cannot generate to all people can resilience to adapt to the stressor like me, the same with me, because it is sunnatullah that Allah give kekayaan, kemiskinan, kesusahan, kesenangan itu sebagai sarana untuk ibadah. Please don't be a perfect people. Don't give a burden to yourself. Yeah. Ada kalanya manusia itu diciptakan naik atau turun. Yeah. God has created man up and down. Sometimes increase and decrease. It is okay. Yeah. Jadi say to yourself, I love you, you have struggle, you need refreshing, you have finished your task in family, you have finished your task in office, in business, Allah Maha Pengasih tidak menuntut yang lebih di luar kemampuan kamu. Yang lain boleh lebih hebat, lebih kaya, lebih tinggi pendidikannya, tapi belum tentu dijamin masuk surga. Dalam di hadapan Allah, kekayaan, kemiskinan, pangkat jabatan, kemudian pendidikan, PhD or not PhD adalah dua-duanya ujian. Resilient cannot be spared by religion or spirituality. I think include in spirituality. As I give an example before that la yukallifu lahu nafsan illa usaha. Allah tidak akan membebani manusia di luar kemampuannya. I think it is the principle of resilience. The conclusion is resilience is different one people to other. And the second conclusion is resilience need support system. And the last conclusion is how to be resilient is as a ujian dari Allah. Apakah dia bisa selamat di dunia atau akhirat. Maybe itu jawaban untuk Ibu Zulfa ya. Mudah-mudahan bisa diterima.
Okay, thank you Pak Ius. Mr. Fahru, your question for to the Professor Bibi, right? Yeah.
Okay. No. Excuse me. No. I'm question from Dr. Ius.
Oh, for Dr. Ius. Okay.
Good morning. Introduce myself. My name is Fahru. I come from Universities of Akbar Hospital, Hospital Gustira. Thank you very much, Dr. Ius. It's great presentation. And I really like the presentation you gave earlier, which explained about resilience, which means positive addiction in the dealing with stress and trauma. And my question is, how we as parent or sibling in the family confess our younger sibling or silent to forget the deep trauma, the experience, and whether this trauma happened because we as parents or siblings did not instill strong root resilience in them. Thank you.
Okay. Ayus, could you catch the question?
Okay. As all reference and expert recommended that pattern of parenting is more important to apply in the family, the member of family, especially to protect the sibling conflict. There are two kind of pattern of parenting. The first is warm and the last is control. If the parent give a high warm and high control, it is called as authoritative. And there are, if the parent give a high control and low warm, it is called as a authoritarian. The conflict usually can occur when the parent give a low controls and low warmth. Jadi konflik-konflik sibling biasa terjadi kalau di dalam keluarga itu kehangatannya rendah, kontrolnya juga rendah. Sehingga terjadi perlombaan mencari perhatian orang tua. Itu secara teori seperti itu. What does control mean? Ini saatnya kamu sekolah, ini saatnya kamu belajar, ini saatnya kamu bantu mama ngepel, ini saatnya kamu belajar pakai kaos kaki sendiri, ini saatnya kamu menutup aurat dan tidak keluar malam. It is called as control. What does a warm? Warm mean dipeluk, dicium, jalan bareng, bermain bareng, jalan-jalan, belanja, curhat, main bola bareng. I think it is very important to apply to prevent a conflict in sibling.
Yeah. Thank you, Payus, for the explanation. I'm so sorry because the time is up, so I will close the first session, and then for the unanswered question, if you don't mind, Prof. Bibi, Pak Ius, could you answer the question in the chat room? So because I will go into the next session, if you don't mind. Thank you very much, Mr. Ius and Prof. Bibi. Always success, always healthy. Nice to
Thank
meet
you, Prof. Bibi. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Okay, ladies and gentlemen.
Certificate, Miss Dina. Miss Dina.
Oh yeah, I forgot.
Giving certificate.
Yeah, the chairman of Aipviki will giving certificate to the speaker. Could you please join again, Mr. Yus and Prof. Bibi?
Yeah. Okay.
sorry, forgot about that.
Okay, terima kasih. Thank you, Prof. Datuk Bibi and Dr. Yus Yosef. You always inspire our, you always inspire us, and I hope you bless every moment. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Terima kasih, Bu Nenden. Terima kasih, Bu Nenden. Thank you, Prof. Bibi.
Okay, thank you, Bu. Now we are going to the second session. Ladies and gentlemen, the session, the first session has ended. Now we are going to the second session. In the second session, there are two extraordinary speakers, which are the Dr. Jericho Pardosi from the Queensland Technology Australia University and Mrs. Hatia Harun. To save the time, we will go to the first speaker in the second session. Let me introduce the first speaker. He is Dr. Jericho Pardosi from the Queensland University of Technology, Australia. Let me read his CV. Yeah. Dr. Jericho Pardosi, his complete philosophy of doctor in 2016 at Macquarie University. And then right now, he has become a lecturer to School of Public Health and Social Work, Queensland University of Technology. And also, he got honors and awards. The first is International Macquarie University Research Excellence Scholarship, Faculty of Business Economic Australia in 2020, and the University of Queensland Indonesia Alumni Award. Yeah. The University of Queensland, Brisbane, Australia, and 2010. So, Dr. Jericho Pardosi. Dr. Jericho Pardosi, now let's please welcome to our third speaker, Dr. Jericho Pardosi, to deliver your presentation. It's about global issue of lecturers and students' resilience during the pandemic in Australian experience. All right, Dr. Jericho Pardosi, have you joined Zoom?
Yes, thank you.
How are you, Dr. Jericho?
I'm very good, thanks. How about you?
Nice to meet you in the first time. Okay, Dr. Jericho, time is your, no more than 30 minutes, right? Thank you.
Okay, I'll try my best, okay?
Okay.
Let me share my screen first. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, Dr. Jericho is here.
Okay, I'll start the presentations. Once again, thank you so much, Ibu Nenden and the organizer for providing the opportunity to share the academic experience as well as student experience in terms of their resilience with the current pandemic of COVID-19. But before that, I just want to mention that this presentation doesn't represent QUT or Australia Higher Education's views on resilience. This is my personal views by using relevant sources and recent studies on students and academics resilience during the COVID-19 pandemic, especially from the Faculty of Health. And I also want to acknowledge the Tarbal and Yagara as the First Nation owners of the land where I now stand, where I live, where I teach, and I do research. I pay respect to their elders, past, present, and emerging, and recognize that this beautiful land have always been places of teaching, research, and learning. And also want to acknowledge the important role Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people play within the QT community. So thank you so much for the brief introductions. That's me. You can see I'm not changed so much from the photos. So for today's sessions, I would like to describe the situations, what we are dealing at the moment in Australia with the COVID-19 pandemic, especially looking at numbers of case studies on nursing students, medical students, as well as public health students. That is the school where I'm coming from at the moment. And we're looking at the impact of COVID-19, as well as what will be the potential solutions from both speakers previously, either from Dr. Eus and also from Professor Bib from Malaysia. They've already shared about what do we mean by resilience. But in terms of the practicality, in terms of understanding, well, we are not the only one who are dealing with this COVID-19 pandemic. So let me remind everyone, this is a quick graph of what happened with the current variant of Omicron. So as you can see, starting from December 21st, 2021, what we are witnessing is a rapid increase of new cases, of newly infected cases with the Omicron. And I'm just using the case study coming from Australia, Singapore, and Indonesia. We are seeing the same trend. Now, if we want to compare between countries in terms of the vaccination coverage and in terms of whether you have first dose, second dose, or even right now, it's the third dose, or what we call the booster. When you look at Indonesia, it's considered quite low, not even reaching 60%, compared with the neighboring countries, for example, Vietnam already reached almost 80%, or even other low middle income countries such as Brazil. So again, this raises questions. How do we deal with numbers of staff or numbers of students who haven't received fully vaccinated COVID-19 dose? Do we have enough protocol to deal with? And from the previous speakers, you've learned about the impact of COVID-19 pandemic. For example, in Australia in early 2020, I still remember by the end of week three, I had an email from the vice chancellor and also the director of QT Learning and Teaching saying that starting next week, we have to move to fully online delivery. And that's create an issue, a challenge, not only for students, as well as for the academics. Because within a very short time frame, we need to adjust, we need to restructure our course delivery, the assessment due date, our group work, even with placement. I still remember I was having a conversation with my colleague from School of Nursing, because they were heavily concerned about how do we deal with this lockdown situations and where we have to send out our nursing students to hospitals, to local community health center. At the end of the day, we come up with a conclusion that we follow the protocol guided by the local health agencies. Of course, this takes a lot of time, huge time, just to prepare our students to be able to join the placement. And another impact of COVID-19 pandemic, for example, for academics, you have to revisit again your research activities. You cannot just go to your research site, which means you have to transform, either you have to delay, or perhaps you have to change the way you collect your data in terms of the methods. And I put this last thing, new protocols. This is something that you will be familiar in your own schools or faculties or department, that now you have what we call new protocols dealing with the current COVID-19 pandemic. And I've been talking in recent months with colleagues from University of Indonesia, University of Diponegoro, in terms of how do we deal with students learning and teaching with the change of delivery, with the platform, changing from face-to-face to online delivery. Now, if you want to know more about the situation in Australia, so here we go. Around 1.4 million university students in Australia, and that's include both domestic or local and international students, with more than 13,000 academics and professional staff. And this includes full-time or even what we call fractional full-time staff, which means You can work only for 4 days, and then you decided not to work on the fifth day. This is what we call fractional full-time staff, or even sometimes we call it as a part-time. And we also have numbers of a casual lecturer or casual tutors. Now, for the government of Australia, they've been kind of historically provide opportunity for their local students, for their citizens, to go to university, but not for free. It's only free when they go to the university. It's what we call Commonwealth supported places. So let's say if you're an Australian citizen, you reside in Brisbane, you want to join QT, then you enroll, then during your study time, the government will pay the school fees or university fees. But once you graduated from your degree, it's time for you to repay back the government. So using a fractionals from your salary, for example, either it's 5% or 7% from your salary need to be paid back what the government already provided. Within Australia, we have 36 universities as part of the World University Ranking from last year. Now, this is the situation, what happened in Australia. When you look at different fields of education, we're seeing an increase starting from 2001 for almost all fields of education, except for agriculture, environmental, and related studies. As you can see on this line, it's considered steady. Not much different in terms of the trends. But when you look at the very top and also some of the field of education, we're seeing a decline of student enrollment. And this is a fair, and I mean, this is pretty obvious, because if you are reside in Sydney, a few months ago, you cannot come to Brisbane so easy because we have a closed border policy. Until recent months, that we've already allowed other people to come to Australia or even interstate trends and travels. How about the international students enrollment and commencement, Jericho? Well, as you can see here, we're seeing another increase since 2015. But then what happened after the early 2020? This is where Australia decided to have that closed border policy. No one can go in easily to Australia. Even as an Australian citizen, you do have to wait. There's a long queue in order for you to come back to Australia, and much worse situations for international students. So that is why what you're looking at the moment on this graph is the rapid decline in terms of the commencement as well as the enrollment of international students. And talking about international students, based on data per January 2022, it is estimated that 55% or 201,052 for higher education enrollment. But in terms of the commencement, it's only 11% out of that number, which is only close to 5,000. So this is our study areas at the Queensland University of Technology. This is where the next speaker, Dr. Hartia, just recently completed her degree from Queensland University of Technology. So congratulations to Dr. Hartia for your achievement. So these are the study areas ranging from architecture to science. And in terms of the Faculty of Health, we have what we call here school. So we have School of Biomedical Sciences, School of Clinical Sciences, and this is where I'm working at the moment, School of Public Health and Social Work. Now, talking about QUT itself, in terms of Indigenous students, QUT Indigenous Australian exceeded 1,000 enrollment for the first time in 2021, with 1.9% staff are Indigenous Australia, and with 1.9% of students, similar percentage are also coming from Indigenous students. This is the program for undergraduate at the School of Public Health and Social Work. We have Bachelor of Public Health to Creative Industries and Human Services. Now, I'm not aware in Indonesia, but in Australia, we do have provided a dual degree or a double degree options. So for example, as a nursing student, you can also do public health at the same time, which means instead of having 3 years or 4 years, then you add another year, 5 years, and then you have 2 degrees. Bachelor of Nursing and a Bachelor of Public Health. In terms of postgraduate, these are the major that we have, ranging from public health to data analytics. Now, I don't want to spend too much time on this one because Dr. Iyu's previous speaker already explained about the resilient. But one thing that I want to kind of propose to many of you is resilience may be defined as the heightened likelihood of success in school and other life accomplishment despite the environmental adversities. And that adversities is the COVID-19 pandemic. And that's why earlier I was saying, you're not the only one who is dealing with the pandemic. Even people in remote and rural areas in Australia, we are struggling to deal with this COVID-19 pandemic. Walker in 2019, he suggested that resilience is about learning how to change in order not to be changed. And this is very interesting kind of definitions being put forward. But the question right now, how about the resilience at the system level instead of focusing on academics and student experience? And I'm not saying that we just neglect student experience, we just forget about academics experience, no. But we also need to ensure that our educational system have a strong resilience in terms of this COVID-19 pandemic. And that's why when you look at numbers of factors, things like trust, when we are talking about trust, it's about enables people to collaborate effectively. Despite the COVID-19 pandemic, can we still build network? Can we do collaborative actions or sessions with other universities? And the answer is a big yes. I've been part of numbers of guest lecture series virtually across Indonesia universities. So I don't have to go there to travel to Indonesia or Jakarta as much as I love to eat nasi uduk. I'm sorry to mention this one. I know many of you in fasting month, but as much as I'm craving of the Indonesian food, but with this COVID pandemic, provide us a new opportunity. At least you don't have to pay for the travel for someone to give a guest lecture or even doing research or joint publications. I've taken this one from a survey by Hickling and colleagues in 2021. So Hickling and colleagues do a survey among public health lecturers and academics in the United States, Canada, and Australia. So it's include 5 universities. And what they found, the barriers with the online teaching as follows: student engagement. So despite moving from face-to-face to online, we are still experiencing low engagement from students. IT issues, how about the support IT issues? Time constraint, limited peer support, limited access to educational technologies or learning designer. I don't have anyone to help me changing my course, for example, but that's not a reason that we have to use as an excuse saying to our student, well, this is it. This is the only thing I'm able to offer to you guys. No, there's also another opportunity. Competing demands with family and life issues, and also worry about job security. In the last 2 years in Australia, unfortunately, many of my colleagues who are working as an academic or professional, they lost their jobs because of restructuring issues within the university because of the low enrollment and need to adjust with the budget. So unfortunately, there's a rising issues of job security. It's the same thing perhaps in Indonesia. Many of my fellow academics a bit worried about your permanent status. Will I be teaching next semester? What will happen to my family? But when you look at this one, this is just an example for my fellow academics in terms of, should I go with live lecture or pre-recorded lecture? From my own experience, it depends. What sort of information that you want to record and what sort of information that you want to engage with your students? For example, with Zoom, we are using Zoom here most of the time at QT, we have a breakout rooms. So we use that breakout rooms to divide students into different groups. So they were able to chat with their own peers. And from time to time, we can just go in and go out through these breakout rooms. And live lecture is not just about delivering lecture and that's it. No, I encourage my fellow academics to give time for your student as well to understand your content, to understand the informations that are being provided. So sometimes use a different varieties like online quizzes, or sometimes have a break and put some music during the live lecture, something that I always did just to ease some of the anxiety because we are dealing with mental illness with the COVID-19 pandemic, unfortunately. Another paper, I'm just combining, so they're looking at academic resilience during the SARS, H1N1, the MERS, the Middle Eastern respiratory systems, the Ebola and COVID. So what they found, it's very interesting. As you can see, it's only a few papers before the pandemic, but have a look what happened during the COVID-19 pandemic. So it doesn't stop YouTube publishing articles, actually. We're seeing more and more published articles during this COVID-19 pandemic. And what they found, this is just a quotations. I have built strong, respectful engagement with my student, but gosh, a lot of work, 9 in the morning to 10 p.m. for 14 weeks. This can't be a new norm. Another quotation saying, the previous slow transition to blended and hybrid learning environments will be accelerated because of huge increase of academic experience. So to my juniors, you know, to students out there listening to this recording, just be patient as well, working with your lecturers. And for my fellow academics, we also need to be patient with our students, because many of them also struggling with their life issues, with their isolations, no friends, no peer support, internet breakouts, even perhaps they don't have their laptops. So this actually leads to a question. How is the resilience of academic staff conceptualized during this COVID-19 pandemic? So what is known about resilience? As an academic staff, resilience you can measure through the staff reflections, the ability for students to apply concepts to the COVID-19 pandemic, visualizing the lecture content. Even recent studies among academics stated that the higher education in Australia find itself in a challenging position. Part public institution, part corporations squeeze between diminishing government outlays and the growing institutions. And to many studies, academics are portrayed within as a scrambling in their transition from face-to-face to the emerging remote teaching during the lockdown period. Things like using Microsoft Teams, Google platform or Zoom, or even learning management systems such as a Blackboard, Canvas. I'm not sure what the learning management system that you are using, but here at QT, we are using Blackboard. Even with Blackboard, do have some limitations. But again, there is not an excuse need to be made for our students. In terms of financial challenges, how about the job security and the social isolations with students that influence low motivations? Now, looking at what is known before COVID with the digital technologies, as you can see on this graph, different countries ranging from Australia, India, China, Cambodia and Malaysia. So the dark blues symbolize the Australia. And this is what happened before. So prior to COVID, well, it's not really a good result in terms of percentage. It's only less than 10% saying that the digital technology tools and delivery consider effective by students, compared to most of them fall into neither effective or somewhat ineffective, or even we still have more than 25 to 35% saying not sure about the digital technologies. And when you look at some of the pre and what happened after the COVID, let's have a look. It's not massive changes in terms of understanding what happened in terms of the confidence using digital technologies. So I'm just taking this one from another studies within the Victoria or the Melbourne by Hamade and colleagues. This is a quote, for example, not having many friends, staying indoor, mostly not being able to see friends at uni made me feel gloomy and stuck. Or working in an environment with possible COVID cases, this is if you're working as a nursing student or if you're working as a medical student, being unsure whether I have attracted the disease. Or even attending clinical placement during the peak of COVID-19 while using public transport, stress my family members, your parents stress out when you go out from your home and then you went to the clinic or hospitals. I'm quite a social person and love to be around. Not having many friends, again, or saying earlier, it's kind of stuck and gloomy. So this is just saying, even with some of the health concern, getting more vitamin D. We are having less vitamin D because of the lockdown situations. So what is known about resilience for students? Remember, they also deal with financial challenges. Perhaps many of their parents as well lost their jobs. So how does the university respond to that financial issues? And also need to understand in terms of you, many of you as a students, in terms of the academic workload. With the rapid transitions, it's also create, and I'm fully aware, it will create anxiety and frustration among students. Even in one recent study in Australia, there's a tendency of suicidal ideation among international students during the COVID-19 pandemic. Internet dropout, we don't have a good internet at home. That kind of stress out most of the time in your situations. Long lectures with lack interaction with students. I'm not pointing finger, but face-to-face, many of you just keep it silent in the lecture room, but during the online, so I'm hoping once we're returning back to the new norm, I'm hoping many of you students will have that actively engagement with your lecturers. Because listen, not everyone having the opportunity to go to university. Not everyone. When you look at the proportions of number of people going to university in Indonesia, you'll be surprised. We still have more than millions of people in Indonesia unable just to attend university. So be grateful and be thankful and use this opportunity despite of the COVID pandemic to excel in terms of your achievement with your study. This is from my own students. So he studied online from India. It was not an easy decision. I wasn't sure whether I could handle the online learning. So I started with two subjects and continued to study more unit in the following semester. So again, I'm not sure with the faculty or university in Indonesia, are you allowing your student, instead of having four unit, so you'll give them flexibility. Okay, let's just give our student flexibility to enroll only one or two unit. Something that many of the chancellors or rector, you probably want to consider this option because this is a very helpful options, the flexibility to your study plan. Academic experience, not much, it's the same. I was fully aware about the potential challenges within the COVID-19 pandemic. I also had to deal with my children's homeschooling. So even in 2020, in the first two semester, both of my kids study at home and I have to teach online as well. So it was not an easy situation for me as parents. So again, think about others as well before you raise your concern as well. And the important thing here, I just put both regular and active. I encourage my fellow academics, please build a regular and active communications with your students and also help them in so many different ways so they could excel in terms of their study progressions. So to conclude, I don't know how many minutes I've already presented this one, but to conclude, what could we do with this pandemic? And I'm just breaking down the word pandemic. I love acronym. So the word P, positive learning environment. As an academic, let's create a positive learning environment. Don't judge some of the students who came late to your Zoom sessions. Perhaps they had to deal with their parents' business, with their helping their parents with their household. So don't judge too early. It's better to ask. For students, don't judge your lecturers. If say, oh, what happened with my lecturers? It's already 10 a.m., but there's no online lecture. Be patient. Everyone is dealing with the same situation. So it is important to create a positive learning environment. Now, I want to share this. Unfortunately, it changed from tragic to a successful story. So during the 2020, on one morning, I received an email from my student who was about to suicide herself. So she sent me an email saying, well, Dr. Jericho, thank you so much for your interactive lectures. but I cannot deal anymore with this COVID-19. I just want to end my life. So as an academic, what would you do if you are in that position, having someone about to suicide themselves by sending an email at that time? So luckily, I managed to contact the students and even met the students, obviously following the protocols, and I encouraged her. And it's very grateful to know that she just graduated from her degree last year. So changing from tragic to a successful story. So something that you need to be aware of, mental health issue is a very serious thing. So don't judge too early. Second thing, appreciate. In this pandemic, appreciate the online teaching and learning. It's not a perfect modules. It's not a perfect delivery. Perhaps some of your lecturers kind of very long lectures provide you with, you know, I've already, you know, this stuff. Why am I wasting my time just hearing to my lectures? Don't say that one. Appreciate the effort. Appreciate the hard work given or put into. The next one, network. Do network with your peers from other universities, from other organizations, from different industries. The pandemic should not stop you in developing and extending your network. And I'm speaking from my own experience and from my student experience. Even some of my students actually managed to get a job before they completed their degree. And this is mainly because they interact with different industries, interact with different organizations virtually. So we have what we call virtual placement.
Excuse me, Dr. Yes. Jericho, 10 minutes live, right?
Say again?
10 minutes live.
Oh yeah, don't worry, I'll finish in 2 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
The next one is develop faculty level support. So for faculty directors, the head of faculty, please work with the student ambassadors, because at the end of the day, what will work is the student experience. So talk to your students, understand your students' needs, understand your student expectations. Now, on the other hand, you also need to have that dialogue with your lecturers, with your academics. Ask them what they need. Perhaps what they need is another educational learning designer. I'm not sure whether you have those facility, but here in Australia, as a unit coordinator, for example, prior to the delivery of your unit, sometimes the university will give you support. If they are thinking, oh, probably Jericho will need the support. Other time, because of a lot of training provided across the university, then you will be able to develop your own learning management, kind of a web page. And I'll show you quickly during the sessions, some of the example. Engage students with critical thinking. Online doesn't mean we have to reduce the critical thinking skills among our students. No, as a matter of fact, we have to improve our students' critical thinking by relying on relevant studies, by also asking for other lecturers' assistance. So I keep saying to my students, I'm not the expert of everything. If I don't know the answer to a certain questions, I do not hesitate by saying to my students, unfortunately, I don't know. And just be honest to your students if you don't know the answer. But one thing that you need to do, find the answer, and the following week or the following sessions, try to explain to them the answers. I'm sure the student will appreciate that one. So we are now closing to the pandemic. More IT and learning designer support for staff and students. The I, investigate. What will be the potential learning design and media? It's not just about recording. Perhaps you could have a short lecture, like 10 minutes lecture, and then you have another 10 minutes lecture. Perhaps that will work for your students instead of listening to 2 hours nonstop lecture. Let's just admit, even when you watch movie in theater, sometimes you can also fall asleep in bioscope, right? With 2 hours movie, sometimes we just fall asleep. Imagine if you're listening to 2 hours talk without no interactive or online kind of games. And when I say games, there's heaps of educational games, things like real life scenarios or positioning yourself. If you are like a patient with COVID-19, what will you do? what sort of methods, what sort of procedures, what sort of a treatment that we need to give to the patients. Last one is the competencies. With the COVID-19 pandemic, one thing for sure, as an academics or as a students, we are being pushed by these current situations to improve our digital alertness, to improve our digital awareness of how to deal with the pandemic situation. And this is the word pandemic stand for if you want to deal with pandemic. So what will be the opportunities, Jericho, for Indonesian academic and students? Collaborate through academics online exchange sessions. Contact guest lecturers from other universities. They will be helpful. And don't worry about, but Pak Jericho, we're not sure how much money that we have to pay for the lectures. Well, guess what? From my own experience, I don't get the prefix like many docent in Indonesia, where you get the honors for different with your salary, different with your teaching time. No, it's already included in my salary. Even if I'm doing research, I'm not allowed to receive honorarium. I'm not allowed to receive honorarium before I actually express that one to the financial officer. Develop joint project like a structure review. At the moment, I'm writing a systematic literature review with numbers of colleagues in Suiga Paranata Catholic University and University of Diponegoro. So we are writing, but we haven't met each other face to face. Conduct virtual courses. You can conduct virtual courses, inviting other lecturers as well, and do joint publications. And these are the references if you want to know more about the situation and recent studies, especially at the Faculty of Health Students and Academic Resilience. I want to close with King quotes. The scariest moment is always just before you start. After that, things can only get better. If you are brave enough to start, you will. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jericho Pardosi. Dr. Jericho Pardosi, if you don't mind, keep stay in the Zoom room. And then after that, we will go into the discussion session to answer all of the questions. And Bu Hartia, are you ready to join in the Zoom room?
Mrs. Wait, Hartia said that.
Alhamdulillah.
No.
Ah, no. Not here.
Her bandwidth is slow, so terlempar beliau.
Oh, wait.
Maybe Mr. Dr. Jericho, Harti Harun.
Wait a minute. I will check first.
Yes.
Oh,
I'm here, Dina. Sorry.
Yeah, Harti Harun.
Sorry for the mistake. Oh, it's so stressful because just before my presentation and the internet connection is just broken. I don't know why.
Okay, Ibu.
Oh my God.
Okay, Ibu.
Thank you. Finally, again.
It's been a long time. I didn't meet you. Finally, I can meet you this evening. How are you? How are you?
Good. Thank you. And you? How are you?
Alhamdulillah, fine. Congratulations for your achievement, Bu.
Yes, you too. You will maybe in the next. Shortly, you will have also the same degree with me.
Yes. maybe next year. I achieve the philosophy of doctor. Okay, Bu. Ladies and gentlemen, now we will move to the last speaker from Pajajaran University. She is my lecturer, my inspiration, Ibu Hartia Harun, PhD, with the topic is about physical fitness and well-being as an essential resilience strategy in the era of new normal. Let me read her CV first. Her full name and title is Hartia Harun, SKP, Master Nursing, MCAS and IFO. He just completed her PhD from Queensland University of Technology. Congratulations, Bu, for your achievement. Right now, she is a senior lecturer from the Pajajaran University. Bu, because there are too many experience from 1988 till now. Sorry.
No, you don't have to read it all.
Yeah, so I can read one by one your work experience.
Don't worry about that.
Time will run out. Okay, Bu. Ibu Hartia Harun, the time is your number than 30 minutes, right, Bu?
Okay, good morning all. Thank you, Ibu Dina, for the nice introduction. And good morning all conference participants. And I really would like to share my enjoyment with Dr. Jericho, because I really enjoy your presentation. How are you, Dr. Jericho? It's been a long time that we haven't met.
I'm very good, Mahartia.
Yeah, we since my departure.
Mahartia is the mother of all PhD students in business.
yes, because I'm the old and the eldest. thank you for sharing the QUT campus what is pictures and also the program. So it brought me back to the my good memory. I think. Okay. Good morning again, and my presentation will be about the physical fitness and well-being as an essential resilience strategies amidst the COVID-19. So have the community share my PowerPoint already? Can you share
slide? Padika, can you share?
Pak Ahmad, maybe.
Oh, Pak Ahmad.
So my presentation will be a bit different with the others, what we have before, like from Dr. Ius or Professor Bibi, and also from I always say when I talk about your name, Jericho, I always say Professor Jericho. So maybe in the next meeting we will have Professor Jericho instead of Dr. Jericho, hopefully. So my presentation will be about physical fitness and well-being as an essential resilience strategies amidst COVID-19. So can we move to the second slide, please? Can we move to the second slide? Okay, hang on. I'm trying to fix my... Okay, as the introduction of why physical resilience is essential and non-separative from the holistic resilience, not only to survive from the COVID-19, but also to succeed, like what all the speakers says, it's not about the coping, in the level of coping, but to succeed amidst the beyond the COVID-19. So we have been challenged by the devastating situation of COVID-19. See, COVID-19 has been creating double stressor in our life. For example, number one stressor for us is the virus itself is a significant stressor to human or biological or psychological states of equilibrium. Around the world, huge number of people died because of the virus. Maybe uncountable number of people experience chronic or long-lasting devastating complication post-COVID-19 infection. And number second is the response from the government, I mean the mitigation of the COVID-19 also create psychosocial and economic stresses. Social distancing, for example, quarantine, work from home, and et cetera. These stressors will be lasting for the long period. So even though for some extent COVID-19 has been decreasing and the government has been changed the policy to ease the social and outdoor activity restriction. And for example, the students and academics have been gradually hybridized. The strategy to in the academic is not only online, like Zoom and so many format, but it's a combination between direct meeting in the class and also with the online
platform. So this change or new way of life will also make people uncertain or even more stressed. Or maybe the word new normal itself is another stressor for us. So when people are asked to be achieved in to be active in the office at or at school or university, the fear of contracting by the virus exists. Moreover, people have been used to work and study from home. We have been for maybe more than 2 years have been doing everything. We have office in our homes. So we have to coming back to work in the office or universities. That can be considered also as stressor. So nevertheless, we cannot avoid to elude the new way of life. In fact, we have to fight and adapt in order to survive in a situation. So perhaps more than survive, we will be a champion. Like I said previously, that when we say, when we talk about resilience, we're not only talking about the coping, but we much more than that. Beyond that, we have to survive, not only survive, but will be, we have to be a champion in to win the situation against all of the uncertainty in our life. So all of these issues become resilient is more important than before if we compare to pre-COVID-19 era. So next slide, please. So I want to talk also highlight a little bit, even though, no, next slide, please. Before this, not this slide, no, this, the second slide. I haven't, this, yes. So, so resilience is the process of adapting. I want, even though Dr. Ius and also Dr. Jericho and Dr. Bibi also has talked about this, but I want to like stressing on the other side, the other perspective of resilience. So talking about the physical resilience. So the process of adapting well in the face of adversity, it means bouncing back from difficult experience from the American Psychological Association. So, and also resilience is the appeal, resilience, as the concept has grown with the expansion of its meaning beyond the capacity to recover from adversity to include toughening up. So tough, we have to be tough. We have to be have to have an adversity question. When we have problem, we have to like, we have to think about how to win, how to not only to combat but also to win. We have to gain the what is the gain, gain opportunity, gain benefits much more before the problem arises. So what Pak Yu said, what Dr. Bibi said, what Dr. Jericho said is also talking about how we fight, how we in the tough situation. So it means that resilient people have the capacity to endure demands. They feel so little distress and they have no needs of recovery. So like I said before, my presentation will be a little bit different because I want all the participants also active in the discussion. So the next slide, please. I want all the participants think about only 1 minute or maybe half a minute, thinking about what do you see about in the picture here. What do you think about, what is the picture talk about? Maybe you can say it, maybe one of you can raise hand, or maybe you can also put your opinion in the chat box, please. What do you see in this picture? Yeah, Ibu Julpa, can you talk about what is your opinion? What is your perception?
Flower in the broken stone. Okay, so in the broken stone, it's, you said that the flower can grow beautifully in the difficult area. So anyone can add some more? This flower is daisy, maybe it's true, but I thought it's also maybe like, oh yeah, it could be daisy, yeah. Anybody can, one or two? What you can see in relation to the resilient? Anybody want to speak one more? No? Okay, just we just continue. So here, if we see that the what, hang on, I'm talking, I'm fixing my laptop. So here we can see how the beautiful daisy is growing in the middle of what is a dryness. Maybe we can see no water, no nutrition for growing so beautifully, but because this flower has the capacity to be resilient, it grow beautifully amidst or in the middle of the what is a problem that this flower what is face. So if we see, we can imagine that if we as a human being live or stay or in the middle of a very stressor stressful situation, we have to have also the capacity to be stay still, healthy, still think what is still thinking about focus, we can decide our life and everything what good can be happening in the middle of the problem, in the middle of a lot of stressor. So next slide, please. Actually, the concept of resilience is a holistic one. It's a holistic resilience. But according to the literature, the resilient concept consists of four different components, which we need to develop in order to support ourselves during challenging times. This include physical resilience, mental resilience, emotional resilience, and social resilience. However, maybe all of you also agree with me, or maybe all of you also aware that we rarely talking about physical resilience. So physical resilience is the least popular aspect of resilience. When we talk about resilience, our thought automatically think about emotional. When we talk about resilience, we talk about how to be mentally resilient or spiritual resilient. So those aspects, those three aspects are more popular than the physical resilience. And physical resilience is almost taken for granted. So we think that we know that we have to be physically fit, physically ready for stress or to face the stress or to manage the coping behavior, to cope, to fight the stressor. But when we think that we know, but we don't think it carefully, we will face some other problem, physical problem in our life. Because even though we refer back to the flower in the previous slide, the flower, even though they the surrounding environment is there is no water, there is no food, maybe for a short period it can be grow beautifully because they have reserve, they have a water reserve, they have oxygen or energy reserve. they have the flower has the capacity to grow for a short period, but when it lasts for a longer time, it will be exhausted. It cannot survive any longer, because to survive, to live, we need some fast physiological or biological process in our body, in our in their what is stem, for example, in their life process, that we need all those biological component, biological chemical what is chemical substance in our body. So we will face what we know in the stress adaptation theory, we call as a exhausted stage. So that's why physical fitness with all those the other three component of resilience, it should be coherently work together. So we cannot any longer undermine or taking for granted the physical fitness, physical resilience, because this component of resilience is essential. It's a prerequisite to be mentally, socially, and economically resilient. So even though we know, we understand, but please refer back or please think back about, do we have already really have have a behavior to maintain our physical fitness or not? We will see in the next slide. Next slide, please. So the physical resilience is, if we refer to this slide, physical resilience is our body's capacity to meet physical challenges when they our body's to capacity to meet physical challenges when they arise, such as sickness or accident, to heal or to manage ongoing physical health condition. So you can imagine in the COVID-19 era, how devastated is COVID-19, COVID virus impact our physical, physical condition or our physical, our physiological equilibrium. So this physical resilience need to be there, not need to be ready even when virus contracted our body, our it will, even though there is so there is a normal physiology, but still when we don't have a reserve to work harder than before the virus enter to our body, so it we will be like a collapse. We will physically collapse. So we will lose, because we have some physical problems such as comorbidity. I'm not sure about the pronunciation. So physical resilience is our body's capacity to meet physical challenges. Okay, to what is a physical resilience component? We'll see it in the next slide. So here, three main areas of physical well-being or physical fitness. Exercise, maybe you all aware about what is a physical exercise. But like I said before, that we have to think, do I have already exercised enough or sufficient exercise? Especially when we have to work in front of the computer, sitting for the very long the whole day. So do we have already exercise regularly or not? So exercise is the one area of to be resilient physically. So the the recommendation is at least 20 minutes a day of exercise, and we have to do that at least 5 times a week. This is only the minimum. If you do more than this, it will be better. But if we think about, if we refer to the psychological, sports psychological concept, there is also the maximum recipe for exercise. We have to think and we have to consider before we doing the exercise. And the ideas for meeting goals of the exercise is, if you work in an office, consider doing work and talk meeting. So instead of, for example, like Professor Dr. Jericho said that, mentioned that even in QUT, when I was there studying for my PhD, almost of the, maybe more recently is already like hybrid study, but still, we are not sure how COVID-19 will happen in the next, in the future, on in the next future. Even though we have experience, for example, Indonesia or around the world, that COVID-19 is already considered is not a pandemic or is not really what is a big problem anymore. But still, we don't know. Maybe virus can be what is appear in the new strain that we don't have to we are not ready to combat that in the normal situation. So if you work in the office, consider doing work and talk. Maybe next time when, for example, Aipviki or any others organization or school want to have the hybrid or face-to-face or in-class meeting, we have to also consider, we have to, like what Professor Dr. Jericho said, being resilient for student and teacher, this is not only on the level of individual, but it has to be on the level of system. System level is mean that school level. The school has to provide or to plan the strategy how to make the student and all the academics keep healthy, keep fit, keep they have a resilient, physical resilient state to meet the demand of the new situation. So for example, student, we have to arrange the student active, active mean not only talk discussion, but physically active or involving the all the muscle to work during the or in between the class, or maybe if we have 1 2-hour class, maybe we have maybe 10 or 5 minutes of walking just around the class, or maybe outdoor. Is depend on the situation, it depend on the planning of the school. So this kind of the exercise, even though the student spend so many time in class, but they still can do exercise regularly. So, and the next one is exercise 5 minutes of walking. Do that every day instead of, for example, instead of the driving your car to the school or to the market, you just walk. So while you have while you do shopping or studying, you also doing your exercise regularly at the same time. And the other one is alternate a brisk pace minute with a moderate pace minute while walking. Also, like maybe while walking, you just jump a little bit, or you also can do some, what is lifting, body lifting while you're walking. So even though we have a very short or limited time to do exercise, but when we clever to plan it while we are doing something, it will be beneficial for us. And the second one is sleep. So between 7 to 9 hours of sleep every night. And ideas for meeting this goal is, for example, to turn off the phone or computer screen 2 hours before bedtime and read a book instead. So like I also have difficulty doing this, or maybe some of you, or maybe most of you also always bring our handphone into our bed. So, and then sometimes just before we close our eyes, we still checking our phone to see whether there is a short message or not. So it is not good attitude to improve our sleep pattern to achieve the goal of 9 hours of sleep or every night. And also avoid coffee after 1 o'clock p.m. At 13 o'clock p.m. Listen to the relaxing music and soothing music. Yeah, for some people maybe love to do that, or just read a book. So or some people maybe when you read Quran, you will just take be sleepy. This is not good actually, but at least for in the perspective of to initiate sleep easily, you can find your pattern, you can your own way. And the last one is the nutrition or diet. A portion control diet that consists of a daily consumption of fruits, vegetables, complex carbohydrate, protein, vitamins, and water. This is so important. So and also this is the ideas of how to meeting the nutritional or diet goal is make half of your plate fruits and vegetables, make half the grains of the whole grain, I think, yeah. And also your important is reduce sodium intake. And then in the next slide we will see how COVID-19 working from home, how our attitude to spend more time in the internet, watching internet, surfing internet, impact our nutrition or dietitian pattern. Okay, next slide is if you refer to the WHO recommendations, just to be active. Just next slide, please. Yeah, into the WHO recommendation. So to be active at home during COVID-19 outbreak, there are five recommendation. Try exercise classes online. Have you done that? I did, but I stopped it. Now I always exercise like cycling, but I bicycle 20 to 30 minutes every day. And then maybe you can dance to music while watching TV. So put on music and then we can dance. Yeah. Play active video games instead of sitting in our chair on the chair and then playing video games. We choose a video game, active video game instead. And try skipping rope. Do some muscle strength and balance training. Yeah, you can do strength training using weight. Using that tools that you have in your house, yeah. You don't need some specific or special tools for strength training. Next slide. The next recommendation from WHO is doing any activity around the home is better than not at all. So be active during COVID is will keep you healthy at home. So in relation to when the school or for example or university want to improve or to facilitate the students and academic resiliency, it means that you have to prepare not only maybe the time but maybe only maybe also the procedure or the equipment. So I remember when I was in QT, there is so many sport or exercise program for physical exercise program for students. So I haven't since I was kid, I couldn't swim. But thanks to QT and also because of COVID-19, maybe so the program, which is also a regular program from QT for international students, free swimming class. So now, alhamdulillah, I can swim because of the school provide the class for students. So this kind of such thing that we as a school we can also provide for those students. So we just not only talk about that student have to be resilient, have to be healthy, have to be cope and everything, but we have also to facilitate all the not only maybe we're not talking about the facility that very costly like swimming pool, but at least we can plan some activity that that very cheap or we don't have an additional funding for that. For example, walking or something, anything else that we can do for the student and also for the academics. And this is also the next slide is if you are at home during COVID-19 outbreaks. I'm still thinking about. Talking about outbreak, even not out, about the pandemic or endemic or anything. Like I said previously, that we don't know whether in the next future what will happen with this virus. So we have to keep maintain our healthy behavior, our fitness, and our let's say COVID behavior, mentally, physically, or socially, and holistically to be ready for the very worst situation, even for the very worst situation. So this is a recommendation of 30 minutes for day or 1 hour daily of for healthy adults, yeah, or student or kids or children. Okay, next. And also, if be active at home during COVID-19 is regularly check your sitting posture. So if you have to sit for a class for example for 2 hours, so be considerate, love yourself. Love your back, love your muscle, love your posture by frequently, for example, doing stretching or just a small, simple walking for maybe half a minute or just every 30 minutes walk, every 30 minutes sitting is always accompanied by 1 minute standing and stretching. So in that case, so please allow the student, if you have the Zoom class, please allow the student or please facilitate the student to do that. Maybe only for 30 seconds, but it will be very good because what WS recommendation is always based on the evidence, not only the recommendation, not unscientific evidence recommendation. The next one. And this is also tips to stay active at home during COVID-19 outbreaks. Walk up and down the stairs. So use your time while you are, for example, receiving a phone or talk in your phone with friends, with colleagues, with your teacher, with your lecture. Instead of you sitting, maybe you just working around while you're talking. That's good. So if you cannot say that you don't have time for exercise, but you should say that I can do exercise anytime I want. Yeah, as long as you have the power to manage your time, to manage your thought, to manage your motivation. And the other one is do some stretching exercise, dance, and everything. This is the same with the previous one. The next one, be active and healthy at home. Also talking about, yeah, it's the same one. During this stressful time, we have to be active. Keep walking, keep use your muscle, body muscle actively every day. Don't forget about that. And next one, the last one from WSO recommendation is regularly check your sitting. Oh, it's the same one. Oh, sorry. Could I put the same thing? Oh, all right. Now we next, however, maybe you all of you also agree, or maybe you are all of you are including me also the victim of the social media of the advertisement, yeah. So according to the UNICEF survey, during COVID-19, 1 in 3 people has increased consumption of sugary drinks, snacks, and sweets, and fats, and fast and prepared food. I mean, fast food is mean, yeah. So 1 in 3, can you imagine? So maybe one. The one here is me, or probably you. And 1 in 3 has decreased consumption of fruit and vegetables. We are not talking about that, about the how the influence of the advertisement, but we cannot avoid, because when we do online study by Zoom, sometimes we also continuously persistently connect to the internet, to the online advertisement. So that's happening to us. Next one. During COVID-19, physical inactivity is the most frequent answer in all ages and gender groups. Yeah, so physical inactivity is the problem. So even though I said that, that's why I said in the beginning of my talk that physical resilience is undermined. This is taken for granted. So it's, when we talk about resiliency, we are always referred to the mental, social, and also spiritual. But and in fact, to be fit, we need all these kind of body fitness, physiology fitness, to be able to cope, to be able to adapt, to be able to combat, fight with the stressful situation. And the last one from the UNICEF survey, that around 1 in 4 reports to see more advertisement of unhealthy or junk food in the media. Yeah, I think we are agree all of this. And actually, the next slide is about the how does my physical well-being help me be more resilient. So this is video. It's a good video about 1.5 minutes. I want you to share with you. This is because this is a good video that we can learn from. Can you open the video, please? Thank you. You haven't shared it
This skill is about the importance of maintaining your physical well-being. Aspects of your physical well-being, notably exercise, sleep, and diet, affect your energy and mood. Improvement in exercise regime, sleep routine, and diet will lead to increased energy, sharper attention and focus, increased productivity, and a better mood. So how can you improve your physical resilience? Incorporate a regular exercise routine, about 20 minutes of exercise a day, 5 days a week. Adopt better sleep habits. Get between 6 and 8 hours of sleep a night. Improve your diet by consuming healthy foods and using portion control. Your diet should consist of a daily consumption of fruits, vegetables, complex carbohydrates, proteins, and water. Remember two important things. First, always consult a physician before making any changes to your diet or exercise regime. Second, making improvements to your physical well-being does not necessarily mean huge changes, as this can be overwhelming. Even small changes can make a big difference. With more attention, focus, and energy, you will be ready to take on challenges that come your way.
So, what the key message is, even small changes can make you different. So just remember about that. Even small changes can make you different. Okay, next slide. Here I want to share with you about the decision matrix. I found it interesting in the physical resilient digital knee board from the supposed resilient, but this is all really relevant to for all the kind of resilient activities. So here there is so many, there is six components that we have to think. So everybody have to think about the three components of the physical resilience. Is maybe you can learn later when you have time, and then reflect of what you have done so far to make yourself physically resilient. So for example, number one is this, this is the area that I used to have a good handle. This is the area I used to have a good handle on, but lately it seemed like I don't. So your exercise activity or your sleep activity pattern or your nutrition or diet pattern has lately has been changed. If you have that experience, you can put a tick on that boxes, whether exercise, sleep, or nutrition. So this is only an idea how you evaluate, how you reflect to your own resilient or your component of physical resilience, and the aims or the purpose of this metric is we can plan, we can plan what has to be changed from our from the recent status or recent the current behavior. So in the next slide, from this matrix we can learn and see how our resilient action plan. So Ibu Citra, is there Ibu Citra here? Ibu Citra will share with you in the chat box three questionnaire that you can click on that link, and then you answer that question, and then we will see the result. I want all of you to participate to answer the question here. Please write three things that you want to start doing, for example, about nutrition, exercise, and sleep. Start doing, yeah? start doing? What do you want to start? According to that, to those three, what is component? Just click the Mentimeter, Ibu Citra. Ibu Mas Dika, can you stop share screen so Ibu Citra can share the screen, her screen? Yeah, good. Okay, thank you. Animal, fruit, vegetables. Maybe want to start to do exercise to improve sleep pattern. Sleep at least 9 hours. Start sleep no more than 10 o'clock p.m. And what else? Please. We have here 530 participants. It should be more than enough to see the beautiful what is variation in the slide in the Ibu Citra presentation. Okay. So here, want to start having an animal maybe just to accompany to work or to make you to reduce the stress. Start to eat vegetables, maybe for someone who does not, who don't like a vegetable, start to eating, start to eat vegetable. Entertain yourself. Pray. An animal still the number one, the bigger one. Okay. Some more. Maybe for another 20 seconds. We will wait for another 20 seconds. Yes, these all are what you want to do in terms of nutrition or diet pattern. You want to change, yeah, to start doing exercise and sleep. How many participants has already responded, Ibu Citra?
14.
Oh, only 14?
Only 14.
From 500?
Yes. Still okay. Counting.
Still working?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, good for the participants who have already actively participate, because this is, I just want to try a different type of presentation. And then these are all the the plan that you want to do. You want to start doing as early as possible to make you have a level of physical high level of physical resiliency. And the next, thank you. On the next questionnaire, our next question is Ibu Citra. I hope this time that all of this participant can participate and answer the question. Please. Please write three things that you want to stop doing, including diet, exercise, and sleep. What do you want to stop doing that? Eating burger? Eating fast food? Sitting in front of the computer for more than 2 hours? Please. Ibu Citra, can share? Oh, being lazy. No more burgers. Pushing yourself too much. Sleep too much. Stop. Instead of less sleep, is sleep too much. Yes. Insecure. Instagram. Stop Instagram. Use phone too much, pushing yourself too much, yes. Exercise, yo, you want to stop doing exercise? Really? Don't, please don't. You should improve your exercise actually. Okay, 30 seconds, more? Okay. Wow, insecure, sleep too much, maybe because of Ramadan? You want to stop sleep too much and then do some exercise instead? Okay. Okay, now the last question, Ibu Citra, thank you for all the participant who has already answered the question. Last question. Okay, please write three things that you want to continue doing. Yeah, so we have already know what should we start doing, stop doing, and what we want to continue to doing that. Okay. Right. Why do you think that you want to continue doing? Insecure? Smile, happy, relationship, wow. Sleep well. Diet too. Eating vegetables, keeping your relationship happy. Happy relationship. Happy relationship and sleep well is the biggest answer for. What is for the things that we want to continue doing. Okay, thank you, Ibu Citra. Maybe,
excuse me, time is up.
Okay. Maybe you can give me another 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah. Continue slide share. 2 minutes, Ibu Dina. Sorry for that.
Okay. It's okay, Bu.
Okay, so you can also play in your when you have time. I can share with you the question. And here, actually, because we only got the limited time to for the presentation. So you can also play with the Zoom fatigue quiz. You can measure how fatigue you are. Related to Zoom activity, yeah, it is interesting. So just go there and then answer all the questions, and then it will appear or the result will appear, and then you will know how fatigued you are in relation to Zoom activity. And the last one is a conclusion. Ibu Din, the last one is conclusion. So learning to accept what we can change and letting go of what we cannot is very important tool in our self-awareness toolkit. So thank you very much. Thank you very much. And my apologize for non-convenient things that I have you have been so many trouble in my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bu Hartia Harun, for the wonderful, interesting. Bu Hartia and Dr. Jericho, are you ready to going to the discussion session? Now we are going to the discussion session, and for the audience can ask the question to the speaker. Just please raise your virtual hand on, just turn on your microphone, or just make a question from the chat feature. And for the first time, maybe I will give the first time to the Dr. Jericho. There is a question from the, what is it? Kevin Efrain. Follow you. Could you catch the question from the chat room, Dr. Jericho?
It's from Kevin, isn't it?
Yes.
I think the question is more for Dr. Hartia, because I think Kevin asked about...
Sorry, Dr. Jericho. I mean, the question from the Nina, Nurmala. From
Nurmala or Nina. I'll answer the questions from Nina from Tasikmalaya. Yeah. Thank you for your questions. How to build critical thinking. When we are talking about critical thinking, we are talking about your analysis skills, how you evaluate, how you inference a certain knowledge or certain content, and how to improve critical knowledge, provide a real-time scenarios, like a real-life scenarios. So for example, if you're a nursing student and you are a lecturer in the School of Nursing, try to incorporate some of the real-life scenarios for your nursing students. That will trigger their critical thinking in terms of, for example, if you have a new patient coming into the emergency room, what will you do? To position themselves, by doing so, they will increase or improve their critical thinking. Another way to improve student critical thinking is to have continuous discussions about up-to-date information regarding on nursing studies or specific topic, for example. That's just a briefly answer. Another question is from Nurmala. What a wonderful explaining. The question is about the effects of new university students for someone who are taking the nursing program in doing practice or client. Oh, for the placement. Yeah, so at the QUT, we have a very strict protocols for sending out our students, whether you are a biomedical student, nursing student, or a public health student, to your placement. So first thing, like, you need to be fully vaccinated. It's not just first dose or second dose. Sometimes the placement location asks the students to have a booster. So you already have three dose. And in certain subjects, you need to complete the Queensland Health online topics about dealing with patients during COVID-19. You also need to be aware about the protocols of agreement that we have with that placement. So you do need to have that discussions with your school, with your faculty, or with your department members, as well as the placement side, on ways for you to sending out your students, because obviously that will influence the resilience. I think that's pretty much my response.
Okay, thank you for the great explanation, Dr. Jericho. I think two questions from Dr. Jericho is enough, because you have another occasion, right, Dr. Jericho?
Yeah, unfortunately. So thank you so much, Ibu Nenden, Nina, and also Dr. Hartia, and everyone here, thank you so much.
No, you don't go anywhere. Just stay still there.
As much as I want to.
Okay, Dr.
I'm still, I'm still enjoying our meeting here with you. Don't go anywhere.
Yeah, I have to go,
okay. Okay, Bu Hartia. Now we are going to the next question.
Maybe you have something to do, but bro, Jericho.
Yes, I have another appointment.
Okay. I will let you go then. Sorry.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you. Hello to your grandson and.
Will do.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Thank
you.
Bye.
See you next time. Okay, Bu Hartia. Now we are going to the next question, ya Bu ya.
Yeah.
Okay, there are too many questions, Bu, in the chat room.
Too many questions.
Yeah.
Wow.
Maybe from the first is from the Kevin Efrain. So how are you? It's about could you
my experience.
Yes.
He said that Kevin is here, right?
Kevin,
could you please share with us some of the memorable experience of your PhD journey in nursing in Australia? Wow, there's so many. All the PhD journey all are memorable. But here I will share. I don't want to share with you the bad things, the bad experience, but. Well, I just want to share with you all the good things, yeah, because I believe that all of you are still much younger than myself. So hopefully in the next future, shortly, you will also pursue or continue your study, for example, in Australia, like myself, or in other countries, maybe. So, actually, my very bold experience when I was taking my PhD in Queensland in QUT. So the all the environment, I mean, in term of the school environment, is always supportive to the student, especially for the international students. Yeah, that's one thing. The other thing that make me easier to cope to study, even though like I said, I can say that my English is not quite good for study. I mean, when we talk like not in the academic paper, yes, I can say I'm good, but when we write something, for example, 300 pages academic paper for my thesis, is quite difficult. So in the beginning, I was struggling. Yeah, I was struggling with how to write the for example, the my biggest challenge is the theoretical framework, because I did my thesis doing a grounded theory. It's not really grounded theory, but it is more than grounded theory, because I didn't do the traditional grounded theory with coding and everything. So I have to, like, I'm a quantitative person, but then I have to change my mindset to qualitative. Then even though qualitative is not the traditional qualitative, but more or beyond than that. So it's so challenging, but my resilience, or my strategy is, I keep doing small step at the time, yeah. And thankfully that my supervisors is always support me, always there for me. So they don't, that was good about studying in Australia, because I have my master degree also from Australia, right? And also now my PhD in Australia. So what good things in Australia is the supervisor or the promoter, or in Indonesia call it promoter, they always appreciate what we have done, yeah. Everything, like I always say like this, I always in confidence say that I'm sorry, my writing is not good, my English is not good, and they always say, no, Hatia, your English is very, always excellent. They always say that. So it encouraged me to be to be brave, yeah. Even though I'm I have so many difficulties, challenges, but I can manage it. I can survive them. I can that's why I actually when someone asks me about my challenge, it's actually not much. Yeah, I really enjoy my PhD. Even though I'm like Pak Jericho said, I am the mother of the PhD student, because I started my PhD in the age of 53. Yeah, it's not easy for the older, nearly elderly, yeah, to study in the other country with English as a first language. It's not difficult, but I didn't feel it is difficult, because I always think positively, and my supervisor always. That's my bold memories about QT and my study.
Okay.
Is that Kevin? I hope you can also join Dr. Jericho, yeah, in QT, yeah. And then you can also don't pay your tuition fee and everything. You can find so many scholarship. Like myself, okay. I got scholarship from Australia Award, and you can get easily also. Okay, what else, Ibu Dina?
The last question from Atar Juman, to Hatia.
Yeah. May, can you? Okay. Atar Juman.
Atar Juman,
can you just speak it instead of, so I want to see your face.
Okay, Atar Juman, are you there here? Atar Juman? Wait. I check first from the name of participant.
Yeah. Okay, so here that he wants to. Wow. He said that Pak Tarjuman said that. Oh, okay. Oh, hello. How are you?
Fine. Kumaha Damang, Bu Hartia.
I'm so happy to meet you here.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, don't ask me difficult question.
No, I just curious. Just curious a simple question.
Okay.
Because your presentation is very interesting for me.
Thank you.
Yeah. Monggo, Bu.
Okay, because like I said, Pak Tarjuman, when we talk about resilience, always think about ting-tung. Ting-tung is about physical, what is emotional resilience, about what is mental resilience. You can see when people, for example, when we see have the conference or seminar, everything about resilience, it is very rarely talking about the physical resilience, even Ibu Nenden, yeah? Because I choose my own topic. Ibu Nenden also focus on the mental resilience, but you have to remember how can be mentally fit if your body lack of energy, yeah? There is a moment that you feel exhausted, yeah, when you don't have any food in any nutrient in your body, in your bloodstream, or you lack of muscle what is fitness, it will also cannot cope mentally or psychologically or so. It is so important before we think about mentally fit, but we have to be physically fit, yeah. So your question is, I think it's not a question actually. Pak Tarjuman actually give me some idea about based on experience. Someone who has good physical well-being, they have been exposed by COVID-19. What do speaker think? Okay. Maybe there is so many athletes also, yeah? Athletes who has contracted or contaminated by COVID-19 or maybe some. So my question is, I'm not sure because we don't know how fit. We can see that these people is fit, or for example, someone is fit at that time. We can see from their background. He is an athlete. His or her figure is so good. Appearance is so good. But we don't know whether at that time, at the moment that virus enter into their body, maybe their immune system is decreasing. So it could be a sort of the even though that person is fit, but the virus can enter anytime. So the message that I want to share with you is, so we have to think though, even though the physically fit person can be or potentially or vulnerable to have virus contraction. So you can imagine how if we are someone who are not physically fit, yeah? So I can't answer exactly why those people, those fit people, physically well-being people have have the potentially, because all of people, even though physically well-being or not, still have the potential to become to be contracted by virus. But what we have to think is that that's why we have to be more than usual or normal being that we have before the COVID. Is that answering your question, Pak Tarjuman?
Pak Tarjuman, have you satisfied for the answer? Pak Tarjuman, Pak Ahmad, unmute please for the Pak Tarjuman. Hello, Pak Ahmad or Pak Dika?
Yeah.
Silakan.
Okay.
Clearly answer. Hatur nuhun, thank you, Bu.
Thank you.
You are now what I mean. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Sorry.
Bu Nenden dan teman-teman ya.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bu Hartia, because I think all of the question is already.
Wow. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the excellent topic, Bu. And then we are going to the certificate award to the speaker. Bu Nenden, could you please?
Okay. Mr. Ahmad. Mr. Ahmad, certificate, please.
It's already there, Ibu Nenden.
Sudah di layar.
Oh. Already there, Ibu Nenden.
Okay. I can see. Yeah. Thank you, Mrs. Dr. Harti Harun. You always inspire me, and thank you for your coaching in my English. Thank you. I want to be you in the next, okay?
I want to be just like you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Bu Hartia.
Thank you. Sorry for all the mistake, because I'm trying not to speak in Bahasa, because I'm also learning English, so you have to also be confident to speak all the time in English.
Yes, of course. Thank you, Bu. Nice to meet you.
Assalamualaikum.
Salam.
And always success, Bu Hartia.
Sami-sami. Okay. Salam, Bu Dina.
Ibu. Ladies and gentlemen, with the end of the discussion session, the webinar will be ended. Thank you to all of the participants who active ask the question and always pay attention from the start to the end. And then thank you for all of the speakers who have provided very excellent and wonderful topic. Once again, thank you to all our presenter and speaker. I, as a moderator, I apologize if there is anything that are less pleasing when I become a moderator. Mrs. Novi, return this session for the time and place to you. Thank you very much. See you next time.
Thank you, Mrs. Dina. All right, ladies and gentlemen, next is the handing over of the certificate for the moderator, which will be delivered by Mrs. Nenden Lesmanawati. Mrs. Nenden?
Yes?
Please send the certificate for the moderator.
Okay, Mrs. Dina? Yeah. I want to thank you very much for your kind and for your always support in Aipviki. I would give this certificate for you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Bu Nenden, for the chance and the opportunity for me to become a moderator. See you next time. Okay.
All right. Thank you for our moderator and all speakers who were amazing at this webinar. All right, ladies and gentlemen. As our best regards, let us watch a video from committee representative. Mr. Ahmad? Mr. Ahmad, could you hear me?
Awang-awang member genjang-jang nabangun taya karingrang sempurna rangawas jeng pamandut nangeluh nopak mega bari tiberna hari ini saha anu bisa ngusulkan tandana kendang jempat tentang taya paningan nana impiga bingir impiga seru sama daya garam kasih yang lain berwawak mena nyanyikna dali panungkan gagahna gelombang sakti Indonesia jaya
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, next we will announce the door prize winners who we choose based on the questionnaires during the discussion session. And here are the door prize winners. Okay, congratulations to the winners. Please contact the committee. Especially, please contact Mrs. Nenden Lesmanawati.
Okay, I wait for you. For your contact, please.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, we have had productive and inspiring time together, and this event about to come to the very end. Before we close this webinar, we will take a photo, and to all of the participants are invited to on the video. We will take a photo. About 2 minutes, and please to all of the participants to on the video. All right, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in the end of this webinar, let us all say hamdalah together. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. As the master of ceremony, thanks to all speakers, Mrs. Nenden Lesmanawati, all co-hosts and the audience entirely. May what we had conducted will be useful for us. On behalf of the committee, we would like to apologize if there is any shortcomings that come from us. Thank you for your attention. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Mr. Dadang.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Mr. Dr. Hartiyah, thank you.
Thank you, and I will leave the
room.
Thank you very much for the
opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you.
May you all have the good health, and don't forget to keep learning. Learning English is important.
Insyaallah.
Thank you
for the motivation, Bu.
Yes. Bye.
Terima kasih, Bu Tantri. Terima kasih, ya.